everyone. Welcome. You're locked into the Search Engine International. I'm your host, Brother Gaja, doing it again today, another Wednesday. Tonight's topic, before we even go there, I want to say first, big up and blessings to all the brothers and sisters who are tuning in all the way from the continent, parts of Africa, Asia, Jamaica, and America, South America, Europe, you know. I know a lot of people tuning in right now. The show's been, you know, getting lots of, you know, comments and reviews and all that. We're going to open up the lines with about an hour and a half to go. At the show, we're going to open the phone lines and take your questions and your comments and all that. Okay? Okay, my guest tonight in the studio is C.K. Quarterman, all right? Now, C.K. Quarterman we're going to be speaking tonight on the Giants and Nephilim, all right? I see people still coming in, getting in. I'm just going to give you a few more minutes to come in. I'm probably going to play one more track, maybe to get Elder Akar in, and then we can go straight into the discussion. My guest tonight is C.K. Quarterman. Our topic is Nephilim, Giants. Are they real? You know, is there evidence of them? We're going to find it out tonight, okay? I said Elder Rakar is in. Let me see if I can pull him in. 1 minute. I'm going to bring in my guest now. We have on the phone here with us in the studio is C.K. Quarterman. C.K. Quarterman, can you hear me?
Yes, I can. Glad to be here.
Glad to have you, man. Could you go ahead for me and introduce yourself to the guests, please?
All right. I wrote a book here recently called Fallen Angels, Giants, UFOs, and the New World Order.
Okay.
It's been out since January. Of course, it's available on Amazon and, of course, on our website. I see you've got a link to it here on your page. And it begins with an exploration of the scripture, some extra biblical literature, which I a lot of times refer to as historical literature, an experience that I had, a little bit of my own story, and it evolves around a call to be aware of the times that we're living in. There's a scripture in Matthew, the 24th chapter and the 37th verse.
Mm-hmm.
And if I'd said the book was based in and around anything, this is what I would say it was based around.
Okay.
But as the days of Noah were, so shall also the coming of the Son of Man be.
Okay.
Now, a lot of people are familiar with that verse, and they can go on and quote to you and say that, for as in the days that were before the flood, they were eating and drinking, marrying and giving in marriage, etc.
Mm-hmm.
But true understanding of Scripture comes from understanding the hearer of the words, what he knew, where he was standing, and what he was thinking.
Well, who was standing? Who?
Pardon?
You said where who was standing, sorry?
The hearer of the scripture. In right. other words, when Christ spoke those words to the disciples,
right?
What did it mean to them?
Okay. See,
we're reading this stuff in the 21st century.
Right.
And we tend to think that we know it all. We tend to read this stuff and think that there's no history behind it.
Right.
Where, in fact, there's a lot of history behind everything that's said and everything that's spoken.
Okay, hold up. Let me ask you before you even go in further.
Mm-hmm.
Are you a Christian? What are you, a Bible scholar? What are you?
Well, I'm a Christian. I hope that I'm a Bible scholar. I think we should all be.
Okay.
I went to Bible school back in the early 90s.
Okay.
And I spent most of my life in business and worked in some parachurch organizations.
Okay.
And got ready to retire a few years ago when the Lord spoke to me.
Right. All right. And I don't want to go too much off. I just wanted to know because, you know, you're quoting the scriptures there. So what are you saying to me? That when Christ was talking, he was talking about something going on at the time of Noah that the world isn't aware of?
That's correct, that the world is not aware of, but the disciples were.
Right. So what was going on in the time of Noah?
Well, what the disciples immediately understood was Genesis, the sixth chapter, the first through the fourth verses.
Right.
It was very popular in literature at that time. For instance, many of your listeners may be familiar with an extra-biblical book called First Enoch.
Mm-hmm.
It talks about those same chapters.
Right.
But in Genesis, the sixth chapter, it says that the sons of God lusted after the daughters of Adam.
Right.
And they came down and took all of those that they chose.
Right.
And that giants were born from this union, men of renown.
Right.
And it said this happened before and after the flood.
Okay.
And this word giants in the Hebrew is Nephilim or Nephilim. Some people will pronounce it one way or another. The Nephilim means more or less, just like the King James translates it, giant or earthborn.
Right.
And these were described in one place as being as tall as the cedars of Lebanon.
Mm-hmm.
And then it also says that this happened after this.
Mm-hmm.
Now, this was very prevalent before the flood, and probably had a lot to do with the flood coming upon the earth.
Right.
And Noah is a very interesting statement made about Noah.
Mm-hmm.
And it says that Noah was perfect in all of his generations.
Mm-hmm.
And that word perfect is the same word that's used of a sacrificial lamb. That means without spot or blemish.
Okay.
In all of his generations, which means that he had a uncorrupted bloodline, which least one.
In other words, no angelic being had any dealings with his blood.
Exactly.
Right.
And it implies that the whole world would become a pretty big mess.
Right.
And of course, we know the story of the flood. And.
But let me ask you this, right?
Mm-hmm.
How you come to this information? When, you know, did you learn it from Bible school or?
No, this isn't typically taught in Bible schools. It's normally actually read over and not too much said about it.
Right.
There are four theories, if you would, about what this is talking about. The one that I just told you about is the one that makes sense and I think is biblically sound.
Okay.
The other thought, which it gained attention in some of the Bible seminaries within the last 100 years, was that the sons of God were Sethites,
right.
The line of Seth.
Right.
But the problem with that is never does a godly line marry an ungodly line or person even and produce a giant.
Yeah.
You know, it just doesn't happen. Doesn't happen in natural life. We don't see that happen.
Right.
And that word, sons of God, is Beniha Elohim, and it's only used 6 times in the book of Job, and it refers to angels.
Right.
And the book of First Enoch absolutely leaves no question that it's referring to angels. And the Septuagint version of the Old Testament, that's the Greek version of the Old Testament, and the Alexandrian version of that, states that the angels, instead of translating it as the sons of God, actually translates it as angels.
Okay.
And, of course, I think we can all agree that these were bad angels, not good angels.
Right.
And so we talk about that in the book, and in some places they're referred to as watchers.
Right.
Which give you the idea that perhaps they started off as good. And due to fact, the book of Enoch says that they actually lusted after the daughters of Adam.
Right.
And the King James Version implies that.
Right. Okay.
And from that union are born the Nephilim.
Well, if you go into the New Testament, I mean, most of the listeners here also, we read the Bible also, and we do follow this teaching also. You understand me?
Mm-hmm.
And you go into the book in the Second Peter chapter 2.
That's correct.
Verse 4 says, "For if God spared not the angels that sin, but cast them down to hell, and delivered them into chains of darkness, be reserved unto judgment." That we know that the angels did sin. You understand me?
That's correct. And so, Jude the 7th verse, you are correct. Yes.
Right. So the thing here is that is there any archaeological evidence of this? Have you found any archaeological evidence of the bones of giants anywhere in your study, in your research?
Well, the web, the internet is full of talk about it.
Okay.
As far as being able to run down a story within the 20th century that one, well, say the 21st century, that one could lock his horns on,
mm-hmm.
There's not. There's anecdotal evidences, there's newspaper accounts, there's newspaper reports from the 19th and the 20th century, and
right.
there's historical accounts.
Right.
But nothing that, a reader could point to and show you a skull. Now, when I say anecdotal, the pharaohs, for instance, of Egypt were possibly in some of these Nephilim. Their heads, if you go to South America today, and there's some African tribes, I understand, that do this as well, it's called boarding, where they take boards and they try to elongate the skull.
Okay.
And I think what that is trying to copy what they originally saw.
Right. I mean, I saw that there's an article in the UK on the BBC that was talking about something very similar like that, about them using board to try and make his skull longer. But the skull that they found and they were showing, there's no way no board could have done that,
Right. And they were trying to copy something that they saw.
Right.
So that's anecdotal evidence. Now, there's also a thing, if you do a search for it on the web, it's called the Star Child Project. Now, the person that's behind the Star Child Project is an ancient astronaut theorist,
okay.
which means he thinks that the world was seeded by ancient astronauts and that he's found a skull of one of these. Well, I think he has found something, but I think what he's found is a Nephilim skull.
Right.
And the DNA of it from the last results that were run are showing that it contains DNA that is not human.
Right.
Now, he would tell you it proves that, the Earth was visited by aliens. Well, I don't think so. I think those aliens were fallen angels.
Right.
And what I do in my book, another question you could ask is this same thing going on today?
Okay.
Is another very good question. And I would say, under the guise of UFOs, the abduction scenario in UFOs, that this same thing is going on today that went on in Genesis, the 6th chapter.
Okay, then.
And I make a case for that in the book.
But how come we're not seeing the giants walking the earth now?
Well, back a couple of years ago in the mountains of North Carolina, I went to take my dog for a walk about 3 o'clock in the morning.
Okay.
And dog's name is Star, and I didn't want to have to take her out, at daylight, so I was still up at 3, so I pushed her out the door. She's usually more than willing to go outside.
Right.
And she and I went outside, and I took the flashlight with me. And while she was outside, my flashlight beam hit some kind of creature that was standing beside a tree. And this creature was 6'7", between that, 10 feet tall. It was huge.
Okay.
And it had a dog or a wolf kind of face on it. And it stood upright, and it looked at me.
Okay.
Now, I think that this is one of those Nephilim. Now, some people would say it's a dog-faced Sasquatch.
Okay.
Well, what's interesting about these Sasquatches is they fit the description of Nephilim, and nobody's ever been able to capture one.
Right.
Nobody's been able to get their hands on one.
Tell me something. Hold up. I don't want to come off. I don't want to come off too far off the topic, but I'm just seeing something here from your website, right?
Mm-hmm.
What's the name of the Most High on your website?
The name of the what?
The name of God. I'm seeing something coming from your website. Ahaya Asha Ahaya. Is that on your website?
Oh, you're talking about the book of Jasha.
Right.
Right. I wrote an article recently about my feelings about the book of Jasha being probably a forgery.
Okay. And why would you say that?
Well, in the 10th chapter of the book of Jasha, in two different places, it uses 10th century names, Lombardy for Italy and Franche for France. And these were not names that would have been available in the second or third century when the book purports to have been written.
Well, you know that there are many versions of the book of Jasha, right?
Five that are extant, yes.
Yeah, so which one isn't authentic?
There are none of them that are authentic. The book of Jasha seems to actually have been lost. The one that's the most popular and popularized on the web is the one that I'm actually referring to, and it was written somewhere around 1553.
Well, you know something, my brother. If you were to throw out the book of Jasha, right?
Mm-hmm.
You have to throw out your Nephilim concept also. I mean, even in the Bible, they had forgeries in the Holy Bible, but we don't throw out the baby with the bathwater. You understand me?
Well, I understand this, that there are other books which are much more credible, First Enoch and the Book of Jubilees, that give color to the Genesis story. I believe that the Bible is inspired and that it is a confident revelation, and it speaks of the Nephilim.
I'm seeing, is it on your website, the name Ahaya Asha Ahaya on it? Can you hear me?
I can hear you, but unless you're referring to the book of Jasha, I'm not sure what you're referring to.
Okay, never mind. I'll go back and get it up in a minute. Yeah, okay. Well, you know something? The book of Jubilees have more forges in it than the book of Jasha. You understand me?
We're not
going to go off on the book of Jasha. You understand me? I mean, you know, Like I'm saying to you, we don't throw out the baby with the bathwater. You understand me?
I understand what you're saying. And, again, I would refer back to, the Masoretic texts. I mean, we've got the book of Genesis, and if anything disagrees with that, then I would take that and then discredit what disagrees with it. And what's left I would call historical literature, and that's the way I personally handle it.
Okay, so let me ask you this then, right? As according to the Bible, who are the children of Israel?
The children of Israel?
Yeah.
That sounds like one of those loaded questions. Who would you say the children of Israel are?
Well, I asked the question.
Well, I think the children of Israel were the descendants of Israel.
Yeah, we know that much. But
well,
who are they in the
earth? There are different theological concepts today about who the children of Israel are, and I don't know that I have really formed a strict opinion about that other than I support the nation of Israel, whether they be right or they're wrong. They're certainly the children of Israel spoken of in the Bible. Now, which, whether or not you accept the church spiritually as part of the children of Israel is another question.
What are you talking about? What are you talking about? You support, when you say you support Israel,
mm-hmm.
What are you talking about?
I'm talking about the nation of Israel.
The nation, and I'm saying to you, who are they today in the earth?
I think if you're not sure where the nation of Israel are, I don't know that we have anything to talk about as far as geographic.
Are you talking about the people over there in the Middle East now? You're talking about them as being the children of Israel?
I think that the nation of Israel, as it exists in the Middle East, is what I said that I support, whether they're right or wrong.
Okay, then. All right, then. Cool. So, but you know Israel isn't a state, right? Israel is a nation of people.
Israel has both Arab Israelis and Jewish Israelis.
No, you're talking about conversion. I'm talking about the bloodline, the real people. I'm talking about the people who crossed the Red Sea with Moses. That's the one I'm talking about.
Well, I do know that they have been able to discern the priestly bloodline through genetics.
Where?
But I don't think the other tribes have been able to be identified.
Okay, so which tribe did you say they have identified? With Levi?
The tribe of Levites, from what I understand, they have found a Conan gene that they've been able to prove through genetics that who has that gene was part of the tribe of the Levites.
Okay, another question again. On your website, right, is there mm-hmm. a sacred name for God?
Okay, you're talking about the article that deals with, does God have a sacred name?
Mm-hmm.
Right, and what's the question there?
I'm asking you, do you have a name that you use?
I think that the article, if you've read the article, it talks about that all throughout the Old Testament, God reveals himself, beginning in Genesis, first chapter, the first verse, as Elohim. And then later on, in a few verses later, he introduces himself as Lord God. And I think that the Old Testament is a progressive revelation of who Elohim is in his covenant relationship with his people. And I think that Jesus is the New Testament name of God without any question. In the Greek, it is.
All right.
And I don't think that God, if you translated the Bible to Spanish, Jesus is called Jesus. And it's just as valid as it is in English as Jesus.
Okay, I'm seeing on your website the name Ahaya Asha Ahaya, right?
I am that I am.
Where did you get that name from?
I believe that comes out of Deuteronomy or Exodus. It's I am that I am, isn't it?
Yes. So is that the name for the Most High, or you just put it there?
Well, I don't agree that the Most High has one name that's more sacred than another.
Right, okay.
That's the whole point of the article. If you want to call him Jehovah or Lord God or I am that I am, he'll answer any of those.
Okay, okay. Wow. Right, so even though it says it in Genesis, in Exodus 3:13 on down, that this is my name forever, You don't think it means anything, no?
No, even what you're referring to is the Hebrew roots movement.
Hebrew.
And even among themselves, they can't agree on which Old Testament name is the sacred name.
What's that? What's the Hebrew roots movement? What's that?
The Hebrew roots movement is a movement to go back to the Hebrew roots of Christianity and to pull out names such as what you're referring to out of the Old Testament as one name more sacred than another. And the groups that are doing that can't even agree upon among themselves which is the most sacred name, whether it's Yah or I am that I am. There's disagreements among those groups.
Okay. Hello, Ricardo, can you hear me?
Yes, I can hear you loud and clear.
All right, man. Nice, man. Nice to have you in.
Bless you.
Yeah, man. We have a guest in the studio tonight, C.K. Quarterman, and we're talking about Nephilim, and we're just going into a little bit on the Hebrew scriptures. We're talking about the name of the Most High. I don't know how much of the show have you heard.
Yeah, I was listening, and I thought I would come in. I want to say, first of all, thank you for coming on, and we appreciate his participation this evening. Right now I'm outside the country, but I would still like to say bless him, and I hope we come to some level of consensus this evening, and to wake up people and have them aware of what's going on within the earth together.
Thank you, Darren.
Let me ask you, sir, because I was listening to you, and what religion do you follow? Are you a Christian?
Certainly I am, yes.
Okay. And the reason I'm asking is because when you look in the scriptures, I was hearing what you were saying that many people can't agree on the name. Whether or not people can agree or disagree have no bearing on the Creator himself and what he said. And I would like to just make a point that maybe you can probably just knock around without opinion so that we can probably come to some mutual consensus. Number one, I think we can agree together that there's no place in Scripture say where no one knows the Most High's name. In Jeremiah, the 23rd chapter, a matter of fact, the Most High God went against the prophets because they were teaching people to forget the Most High's name. In Jeremiah 23 and 27, 26 and 27, it says, how long shall this be in the heart of the prophets that prophesy lies, saying, I have dreamed, which think to cause my people to forget my name by their dreams, which they tell everyone to his neighbor, as their fathers have forgotten my name for Baal. So a few key things in the scripture, the Hebrews here. You have people coming with philosophy based on whatever comes to them through dreams or what have you. And then we also understand that, according to scripture, that we have forgotten the Most High's name for Baal. Now, when you go into the book of Hosea, and it tells us that we forgot the Most High's name for Baali. Baali, in the Hebrew tetragrammaton, is Yahweh or Yahweh. So there's...
Well, let me ask you this. The New Testament.
Yes.
Is it not written in Greek?
Yes, it is.
Okay. So we can agree on that. And the Old Testament is written in Greek, in the Septuagint version, which is Greek, and in the Masoretic version, which is Hebrew. Do we agree on that?
Well, there was no Septuagint. The Septuagint was translated out of the Hebrew so that the Greeks can understand the Hebrew's culture. But if we want to talk about the Old Testament...
Septuagint was very popular at the time of Christ, and it was very much...
Well, it was popular according to the Greeks. But the Hebrews had the Hebrew scrolls, and that's what the Old Testament was translated out of.
Okay, we'll go with that.
Okay. But then still, going back to the original premise that no one knows the Most High's name, why don't we start with what he told us? And I think that's the biggest problem when it comes to man. Man deals with philosophy, opposed to listening to the words of the Most High and following him. There's no purpose. There's no reason to go off of anything outside of what the Most High said. And that's our issue. Not with Christians, not just us in general, coming up with our own philosophies and creating our own religions outside of what the Most High said. There should be no argument of what the Most High name is. Because Christ said himself, many shall come in my name and say, I am Christ, and shall deceive many. So the deception will come down the line. So if we know there's deception, why don't we go back to what the Most High said and build from there, opposed to just dealing with this level of ambiguity?
Well, we can certainly not be ambiguous if we come to the New Testament. In the New Testament, it's certainly not ambiguous at all. The Greek is fairly clear as far as God's name. God's name is Jesus. And there's no way you can translate that as Yeshua or Yeshua. It's not there.
I understand what you're saying, sir. But Christ was not a Greek. Christ was a Hebrew.
I understand that. What does the New Testament scripture call him? I didn't come on this show tonight to argue whether God had a sacred name or not. But if you want to make an argument about whether God has a sacred name or not, let's talk New Testament. Let's talk about Jesus. You know, maybe he certainly was Hebrew, but the New Testament calls him Jesus.
We can agree, brother, that the New Testament calls him Jesus. But the point of the matter is, that's why I wanted to come in, and we could just go into the next topic if you would like. All right. According to the Bible, when the Most High gave the Hebrews his name, was I Am That I Am, until the prophets taught people to forget it. And that was before the Greek Empire. That was before the Romans. That's the point we're trying to make. Like, we need to come back and start from the bare root so that we can move the deception. Christ wasn't called Jesus when he was walking this earth. There was no such thing, no such word as a J, no such letter, excuse me, as a J when Christ was walking the earth. It would be utterly impossible for him to have been called Jesus. That's the point we're making here. And Christ tells us that we cannot deny his name or reject him. Satan has used all these tactics through time to deceive us and move us into paganism. So we have to be able to discuss these things openly and tell the people that the whole world has been deceived on every level, even Christians. And that's the point that I was trying to make with that. We just can't push it off and say, everybody call them different names and they can't agree, so we call them Jesus. But they don't work that way. Someone has to stand for what's right, what's true, what was original. Like the Creator himself. Okay? So I don't want to argue this point, but I wanted to drive that home that we need to go beyond what we've been taught in modern society. Okay? That's the points that I wanted to drive home.
Okay, well, you've made your point.
Okay, well, bless you. And I yield back to the brother that's moderating tonight as far as the host, actually, not the moderator. This is not a debate. All right. So thank you for coming on. And I'll sit back and I'll listen.
Okay. Started off on the topic of we're going to talk about the Nephilim, the giants in the earth, linking it into scripture and, find out why is it that, we're not being taught that in mainstream education, or even in the seminaries, in the theologian seminaries, what's hiding there. I mean, you made some points before earlier when you went into Matthew 24 and 37, and we teach a similar, if not same doctrine where that is concerned, why is it that this has been hidden in society today?
Well, I think the reason that seminaries don't talk about it, and the reason that most churches don't talk about it, is that it's sort of like an elephant in the room. It's there, you just have to keep walking around it with your eyes closed. Most people are very uncomfortable with the supernatural. They're not... they'll go to great lengths to take even the supernatural out of the Bible. Goliath, instead of being the son of a giant and being huge, is shrunk down to be 6 or 7 feet tall, and David shrunk down to 5 feet. You know, there's just been a move in the last probably 100 years to try to take the supernatural totally out of the Bible. And when you do that, it becomes something that you read over sections of it because there's no way you can really make it make sense. Like I mentioned, the different theories on the sixth chapter of Genesis, one of the others is that the sons of God or the Bene Aholohim were judges or princely people. Well, see, it doesn't hold water again that they would produce giants. So what you do is you just sort of read over those things, and to some people, I mean, I talk with people across the world on Facebook and everything, you mention angels having sex, and they just go bananas. They just can't almost handle the idea, and of course, you always get back to Matthew, where it talks about the angels in heaven don't marry or are given in marriage. But those are holy angels in heaven that are compared to the resurrection. That's not ungodly fallen angels who are very capable of taking on human form. They did so to Abraham. An angel wrestled with Jacob. And you can only assume if these angels are able to take on human form, they also have human anatomical parts. And, of course, the historical text of Jubilees and First Enoch elaborates quite a bit upon their anatomical parts being very human, or even more so. So most people, I think, are just plain uncomfortable with the idea.
Well, tell me something. How can people, I mean, in one breath, they say that they can't understand that, but in the same breath, they can believe in a virgin birth?
Because I think that's been mainstream and been taught mainstream. These other things just have not been taught.
Right. So do you teach a virgin birth where Christ is concerned?
Certainly.
Say again?
I said certainly.
Okay, then. But like I'm saying, though, if this is, you know, I don't want to go off on the conversation, but I mean, it's one of them. Wouldn't Christ have been a Nephilim had he been conceived by the Spirit?
No. A fallen angel that mates with a human or with an animal creates a Nephilim.
Right.
When God overshadowed the Virgin Mary, it was quite a bit of differences there. One is it wasn't against her will. She agreed with it.
Right.
Secondly, you're talking about the Holy Spirit of God. You're not talking about a fallen angel.
So you're saying that God destroyed the earth because these angels came and slept with women but sent his son in that same form. What did he destroy the earth for?
Well, I'm saying that God destroyed the earth because of man's wickedness, number one. And part of the reason for man's wickedness was what he saw going on the earth with all of the interbreeding and the hybrids.
Okay.
We're told that the Nephilim created the Eloid, and the Eloid created the Elegy. And this just corrupted right on down through the lines of mankind. Almost there was no perfect or no generations of people that had not been corrupted.
Right.
And, of course, it brought about mankind's wickedness. So God destroyed the world because mankind was wicked, but mankind was wicked because he had adopted the ways of the Nephilim.
Okay, all right. You know, we can stay on that. Well, Elder Ricard, do you have anything to say to that?
Well, no. I'm just listening, and everything is, he's right on, and I just wanted to, as far as the Nephilim is concerned. Concerning the Nephilim and how it's really mainstream ignores it, but I think it's more purpose on the lines of this brother here. I think that the Roman Catholic Church is actually hiding through their theology the gods they worship. So they would rather you believe that these were women dealt with the sons of Seth, opposed to the fallen angels that fell.
And this begins with the Catholic theologian St. Augustine. That theory did begin with him.
Exactly. And they're burning candles and doing idolatry, witchcraft to these fallen angels that fell before the flood. And their children, who are Nephilim, who are demons today, they use different types of invocation to have power over people. So this is really higher knowledge over population with Christianity, which is really, I'm not going to say all Christianity, because pre-Constantine Christians were good Christians. But all in all, the Catholic Church has spun their web of deceit to make people believe there is not a supernatural like the brother is bringing forth, and to hide the deities and demons they worship, including the fallen angels. So that's why they ignore this in theology and teach that it's impossible for angels. Angels do it all the time. As the days of Noah, then shall the coming of the Son of Man be. So it didn't just stop back then. We're dealing with extraterrestrial intervention all the time.
That's exactly what I talked about in my book. That's why the title of the book is UFOs and the New World Order. And Genesis, the sixth chapter today, is still happening. And that's part of what I talk about in the book. And, you know, my mission, if you would, is to let people know that these things are still happening.
Okay, now, that's good. Let me ask you, what's your tie-in with the Illuminati New World Order and the fallen angels?
Well, my tie-in there is that, according to Daniel, that the world is controlled by fallen angels, and they pull the strings of the Illuminati and all of the lesser conspirators. But the true conspirators are fallen angels who are even present in the world today in human form. Because after the flood, there was another incursion of fallen angels. That's where you get Goliath from. So if there was another incursion of fallen angels where they took human form, we're never told those fallen angels are locked up anywhere. That means that there are some of them still walking the earth today. And they're the ones that are truly behind the powers that be. I wrote an article recently talking about the Beast of Jekyll Island. That's the, which I'm sure you're familiar with that. The banking cartels and the Federal Reserve and that kind of thing. The halls of power are certainly, you know, their strings are being pulled by, I think, invisible forces. I think those who are, you know, would call themselves the Illuminati, I think they're just pawns of fallen angels.
Okay, well, hey, we're right on together with that, brother, I tell you that. So let me ask you some detailed questions that others would probably, I know some of the callers would like to come in with it too, but I need to ask, when it comes to this, some might ask, well, what are the fallen angels' mission? What are their mission over government? What are they looking to accomplish? We know there's all types of bases, underground caverns and layers under in different areas like Arizona, near Mexico. Even in Virginia, there's underground caverns. All over where there's bases, there's a link in with these underground caverns. So some people might ask, well, what is the mission of these fallen angels? Now, we know what the Bible says, that they what they did, but do they have an overall mission that people need to be aware of?
They do. And part of that will be disclosed to the world when they come forth with what I would use the term disclosure. Fallen angels call themselves aliens. They put off to the world's governments that they are aliens from other dimensions or other, well, not other dimensions, but other planets, where in reality they're fallen angels from another dimension. Where they're taking things is explained in the Bible in the time of Jacob's trouble, and that is they're pushing the world to a new, what was commonly called a new world order. And that's a one world monetary system. That's a world that's dictated through and by the Antichrist and the beast, and that contains the mark of the beast. And that is the agenda. That's where it's pushing toward, and that's where it's heading toward.
And just say hypothetically, because we all know about the mark of the beast, I'm asking hypothetically, if they were to accomplish this, what is their underlying, what is their end game?
What is their,
these things are implemented?
What is their agenda?
Yeah, what is the end game? At the end of all this, what do they hope to accomplish?
Well, the way I read the book of Revelation is that there's going to be a much more primitive time coming. I read one scholar the other day that stated that he thought, from what he had studied, that 50% of the world's population would be destroyed. We know in the first part of the book of Revelation, when the horsemen begin to ride, that a third of the green grass is burned up. And we can just assume that's a lot of people. And then you have wormwood, and then you have a comet or an asteroid of something of that magnitude that hits the Earth. So we're talking about sending the Earth back to the Dark Ages, not to a more sophisticated, computerized, futuristic world. And I think a lot of people make a mistake when they think in those terms. You know, it's going to be a time that people are looking for help. They're going to be looking for a leader to arrive. And my opinion is that this beast that's talked about in Revelation will be these fallen angels. I believe that they're going to come forth in the world. They'll be seen by people. And they'll be calling themselves aliens. But in reality, remember, that's not what they are. They're going to be some of these hybrids that I've talked about, some of these Nephilim. They're going to be, at some point in time, Satan is kicked out of the spiritual realm and ends up on Earth and with his other angels. So this is going to be a time that we're going to see things that are very unhuman. And that's sort of the agenda of where things are going. It's going to be a time that's going to be like none other.
Oh, okay, so in a nutshell, what I'm trying to get, because right now, even though I respect your opinion, I'm really getting your theoretical view, which is okay, because we have these scriptures as, you know, as a point of reference that we can agree. I'm glad you are in these scriptures far longer than most of the Christians that we've been speaking to. But when I ask you what is their end game, you believe that they're going to, well, we know that they're looking to destroy mankind. That's in a nutshell. But you think that we're going back to a primitive age.
So a primitive
age,
yes. And their end game.
I was just wondering, what was their end game? Like, at the end of this, what is the accomplishment of these so-called? They have an agenda, obviously. They're in total order.
Right. Well, the agenda would be to oppose Christ and his coming, but they won't have very much chance of doing that.
Exactly. Okay. Also, I'm with you. So, now, what I'm going to do, and I'm not disagreeing with you, what I'm going to do is I'm going to try to see if we can come on one accord.
Okay, one second. I'm not hearing any of that, what Elder is saying.
Okay, this is...
Yeah, Brother, I'm not hearing anything either. I can't make heads or tails out of it.
Yeah, this is Brother Gabbar. He's going to be calling back in a few minutes, and he's going to switch over to another computer or another location. We apologize because he's calling, he's overseas, so these things sometimes become an issue. So he's going to be calling back in a few minutes.
Okay.
Mr. Quarterman, are you there?
I'm here. Mm-hmm.
Oh, okay. Okay. Gadja, he's going to be joining us in a few minutes. Okay. Brother Gadja, you there? Let's see. Let me try to bring him back on. Brother Gadja. Hey, Brother Gadja.
Shalom. Can you hear me?
Yes. Okay. We're back in the red room, so to speak. We're live. So we're back on from the break. Elder Ricard has not called back yet. And,
okay.
I had some. I'll get some questions for Mr. Quarterman, and in regards to historical, I want to know what was your take on. There has been in every culture, at least every ancient culture, there's some form of story of within the culture of that culture being visited by, you know, outside force or outside creatures or aliens or some form of gods, what they call gods and things of that nature. I mean, we could go from the Incas, the Mayans, the ancient Babylonians, the Sumerian texts. I mean, the list goes on and on and on. What is your take on these historical, you know, records of these ancient cultures being visited by gods or aliens?
Well, first of all, like I mentioned earlier, I don't believe in aliens from other planets. I do believe in fallen angels and demonic beings and Nephilim. The visitors referred to in the Mesoamerican culture referred to themselves as star gods. And
okay.
That's the same thing we have these UFOs doing today. You know, they're referring to themselves as aliens from the stars.
Okay.
And you can, like you said, see this same kernel of truth all down through history and through the different cultures, just like you have stories of the flood.
Okay.
And almost every culture has a story of the great flood.
Yes.
And there are kernels of truth in those stories. The stories of the Romans and particularly the Greek mythology, where you have the gods, so to speak, I would say with a little g, that come down and they have relations with, you know, the daughters of men, and they produce people like Hercules and these demigods.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
These are all kernels of truth of what took place in Genesis and later on when the children of Israel went into Canaan land, what they ran into.
Mm-hmm.
These things are seen all over the world. It's like, how did these ancient cultures build all these megaliths?
Right.
Pyramids and some of which they're still continuing to find even today.
Now, What is your opinion on, because when we live in an age of, you know, the super information highway, information is very attainable these days, and, you know, many people that are atheists or don't believe in God per se are saying, the excuse is saying, well, what the people in the Bible view as gods were actually aliens from other planets, okay? And my question is, why do you think? Because clearly, if the church in general will embrace the books of Enoch, which is as mentioned in the Bible, and they will embrace the understanding that the sons of God are in fact the angels or the watchers that came down, the fallen angels, that will explain this particular spin. You know, because I have friends of that Christian or were Christians and started getting into other philosophy because this information came across them and they said, okay, these were not gods or the supreme God as we see it in the Bible. These were other aliens. So why do you think the Bible, I mean, the mainline Christians is not really defending and using the fallen angel story will clearly clarify that? What's your view on that?
Well, I think it's part of our culture today and part of what you see going on in the History Channel and the Discovery Channel.
Right.
And that was all instigated by Stitchin, who was supposed to be an expert in the Sumerian language.
Mm-hmm.
which he actually turned out not to have any real qualifications in ancient languages at all.
You're talking Zachariah Sitchin?
Hmm?
You're talking Zachariah Sitchin?
That's right, uh-huh. And he popularized the ancient astronaut theory, and that's been picked up by the History Channel and the Discovery Channel, and tons of movies have been made all about the fact that mankind was seeded by extraterrestrial beings. And there are people that would rather believe that than believe that there's a God that they have to justify themselves to on the Day of Judgment. You know, it's much easier to create your own God on your own terms than it is to pick up the Bible and read and understand you have to one day stand before judgment and that God has specific rights and wrongs, and they may not be yours. You might have to change your ways.
Okay. And pick it back what Elder Ricard was saying earlier, and he's going to be coming in a few minutes. The end game, what they want, I guess, the top luminous, the top devil worshippers, they know they're dealing with this forbidden knowledge of the fallen angels. Okay, we have this information. What we as Bible believers should do in regards of warning people, okay, we're warning people, but more importantly, what should we do as a church? We have our ideas what we are doing. We are preparing, but what you recommend if someone who is a Christian and come across information, what that person or that church should do, in your opinion?
Well, you know, there are three standard views of when Christ is going to return as far as the rapture is concerned. And what I like to do is I like to say this, that the church is nowhere guaranteed an easy time. So it doesn't matter what view that you pick. The thing that we need to do, and the federal government here in America has been talking about it, state governments are talking about it, is that we first of all need to prepare ourselves spiritually. We need to have Christ dwelling in our hearts. And secondly, we need to begin to prepare putting food away. We need to get out of the stock market if we're in it. We need to put away things that we can prepare to go through some very difficult times. And if we do that, we won't be like a squirrel running around hunting a nut. We could actually be like a light on a hill. We could take people who don't know Christ. When these kind of things start coming on the earth, it says that men's hearts shall fail them due to fear.
Yes.
And I think that's literal. And if the church is prepared as to what these things are going to look like, and they're prepared physically, they've got some stuff tucked away, they're in, I like to use the word support groups.
Right.
You know, the early church, one of its great strengths was that they all gathered together.
Yes.
And the church today is fragmented. And what we need to do in our neighborhoods and where we live, we need to find the Christians who are in it. And we need to come together and start preparing together. There's strength in numbers.
Okay, let me ask you this, right?
Mm-hmm.
Do you believe that the hierarchy of the church, right? I'm not talking about your corner street Sunday church. I'm talking about the head at the very top. Who controls it, yeah? Who push the doctrine? Who have the shot? Do you think they know about this?
No, I think they're all blind.
You think all the from the very top of the church?
Well, you're talking about, you know, many different denominations. What I can understand, most of them are blind, and they're pushing their own agendas.
Right.
You know, particularly here in America, we want a better day for our children. We want a better tomorrow for our children than we had for ourselves.
So you believe that the church, and for a better word, and sold out then?
Oh, it sold itself out to the god of mammon, yeah.
Okay. Mm-hmm. Yeah, that's, you know, Okay, sorry, go ahead.
And to piggyback what you were saying, brother, when you mentioned preparing, and we as a church, we are doing that, and we are basically, in a nutshell, not to give every detail on what we're doing as a church here in the open air, but we do believe that there's going to be certain cities that are going to be, or certain areas that are going to be safe, and in certain areas that are not going to be safe. We believe that America is going to be one of those areas that is not going to be safe. And let me just give you a quick rundown why we believe that. I'm pretty sure you're familiar with the book of Daniel in the seventh chapter. In the seventh chapter, the Most High revealed four major beasts that will rise up of the earth, which represents governments. We all know that the first beast was the Babylonian Empire, the second was the Persian and the Medes, the third the Greeks, and the fourth and final is the Roman Empire. Out of the Roman Empire came forth 10 horns. Out of the 10 horns came out, three were plucked out, and out of the three came a little horn. We believe that the little horn that came out of the three horns that were plucked out, we believe that the three horns came out of the 10, which is the European Union, and the three horns represents Britain, France, and Spain, the three countries that established the United States of America. We also believe that the United States of America is the whore mentioned in the book of Revelations, and also the book of Revelations 18 in particular. So we are planning to exit. And some brothers and sisters already in the church are already looking outside of the country for safe haven. Now, I would agree with that. Most people sometimes believe that the Babylon is, some people believe, or the whore is the Catholic Church, or is the world in general. We look at the Bible a little different. What we do, that the Bible always talked about government and practical things that we could see, touch, and feel. You know, when, you know, Daniel saw the four beasts.
I agree that America is Mystery Babylon.
Okay, great. So we thank the Most High that you are looking into preparing, because things are going to get much worse. And we don't believe in the rapture as the mainstream religious institution do, in the sense that the rapture is going to come first, then the Antichrist, and then Christ is going to come back and destroy the Antichrist.
Right.
We don't believe it. We believe when Christ comes back and we'll be taken and meet him in the air, we will be going what the world called Jacob's trouble.
Right. And many
things that happened to the Christians and the Jews in 70 AD, they were killed, they were beheaded for the name of Christ, they were slaughtered, thrown into the synagogues, and these things are going to happen again. You know, and the Bible says two woes has happened, and then one woe is to come, and we believe that's Jacob's trouble.
I'm actually post-trib myself.
I'm sorry, repeat that?
I say I'm also post-trib. I believe the rapture happens at the end of the tribulation.
Yeah, and do you think that doctrine has been presented to the mainstream church to kind of give the impression or that we don't need to worry?
Absolutely. I think it's one of the worst things that ever have happened to the American church, is because they feel they're going to be raptured out of here. They're not preparing for hard times.
Mm-hmm.
But the problem is, not a single one of them I've ever asked can tell me if I ask them, tell me how bad is it going to get before you feel like you're going to be raptured out of here? I can't find a single person who can tell me how bad it's going to get, and they all fall back on the fact that, well, God's not going to let it get bad. And then I say, well, what about all of the foreign countries? You think people in Africa today getting their hands chopped off and their feet chopped off because they're followers of Christ in these Muslim countries? You think they think they're going to get delivered out of here in the blink of an eye and get out of all the trouble they're in?
Mm-hmm.
I said, no, I think you'd better prepare, because even if your doctrine is right, you don't know how bad it's going to get or how much persecution you're going to have to go through. if you prepare today, you can be a light tomorrow to the world. But if you don't prepare today, you'll be out there like a squirrel hunting a nut to eat yourself. You won't be any good to anybody.
And also, good thing you mentioned about that, about, you know, in different countries, you know, Christians are getting killed and things of that nature. I believe, and through our research, and we know this personally because we do have people in different parts of the world, Africa, in different countries of Europe, and things of that nature. And so we have people on the ground, and they can actually see what's really going on. And what we're getting from their reports is that the mainstream media, especially in America, is clearly you know, propaganda. And I think in the mainstream cities, they promote that America is the only place where there is civilization, there is freedom of religion. They give the impression that the whole world is going chaos, and I believe that is intentionally designed to have us keep stay here. And I truly believe that one of the hardest one of the countries that are going to get the hardest hit is America, to the point that I urge every God-fearing man and woman or child to start looking for other refuge. Believe it or not, one of the safest places that we're going to be in the last days is areas that you could plant your own food, make your own clothing, and be self-sustained. And believe it or not, well, we consider third world countries or the people there are from third world country, when it's all said and done, believe it or not, those are the people that are going to have a better chance than, you know, us Americans, you know, with the Starbucks and the, you know, the drive-thrus and the, you know, fast food restaurants. And, we, you know, many of our people don't know how to survive on our own. They don't know how to, you know, even to begin to even plant a seed. And I think the media is also playing some to that and giving some illusion that America or any first world country is the only safe place. And that's and I could speak for experience because I did some travel. That's a lie. And actually, when it all comes down, especially when this dollar collapse, and I would like for you to hear your opinion about the dollar and what do you think, you know, how long it's going to last. You know, the people that are going to survive are the people that are going to be by the river and they can fish. They got a little hunt. They got a little farm in the back, and they've been doing it for a long time, and those are the people that are going to be king in the world to come. So what's your opinion on the dollar?
Well, I think that what we agree on is that America is Mystery Babylon, and in so agreeing, I think you'd probably also agree that Mystery Babylon meets its destruction halfway through the tribulation. It's destroyed overnight.
Yes.
So it does not look good for America. Personally, I'm considering by that time I've got a motorhome. I bought it a few years ago. And this is part of what I felt like God called me to do. And I'm personally planning on maybe, you know, immigrating up to Canada by that time.
Okay.
Principally because, you know, I think one of the things you have to consider is in a third world country is, do you speak the language? How much are you going to stand out from the population? If you don't speak the language and you're going to stand out from the population, I think you're better off trying to hunker down where you're at.
Right.
Okay,
I think Elder Ricard is back on. But let me just, you know, continue, you know, piggyback on that about, you know, third world population speaking the language. And one thing that is, we could know this, we know about this firsthand, you know, people, the human language is more common than, you know, government language, if you will. And my recommendation to you, brothers, maybe travel a little bit to see different parts of the world, because we believe that this side of the equator, or this side of the world, North America, this part, including Canada, you know, you may be able to withstand a little longer than the people there in the big cities, but When a nuclear bomb hits, you also have to remember the aftermath. You have the radiation. You have, you know, this part is not going to be pretty for most people. And
I agree with that.
Yeah. 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 So you should maybe consider maybe looking into other parts of outside of the continent of North America. But Elder Ricard, you, I think you're back.
Yes, I apologize. I think I got a more stable line now. Can you all hear me?
Mm-hmm.
You're coming in fine.
Okay, great, great. I don't know where to pick off at. Maybe we need to open it up soon. But one thing I wanted to mention to the brother, are you a reverend? I'm going to definitely get your book. It's interesting. Are you a minister, or you just a believing Christian?
Well, that's always sort of a loaded question. I'm a believing Christian always and always first.
Okay.
I'm an author, and I went to Bible college, and I'll be starting sort of an on-the-ground ministry next year.
Okay.
But what I try to do is let me just share this with you. I try to stay away from denominational names.
Okay.
I've been to every kind of church you can imagine. I've been a part of, churches of God, Baptist churches, you name it, I've been to them, and I find a core group of people in all of them that love God and that are sincere believers. They don't always believe alike. So I try not to align myself with any particular group, and the older I've gotten, the more I see that my particular views are harder to line up with anybody's boxed views anyway. If you follow what I'm saying.
Yeah, I'm following you. I'm with you. So in a nutshell, you know, of course, the Most High have you on a path. You have a path that you, a goal that was put in you to accomplish for the Creator. What the key point that I wanted to make before we went off is that we know that there is certain deceit within the roots of Christianity since Constantine. Not that the people are bad, like you were mentioning earlier. The people genuinely love God. But our issue is that the people have been deceitfully moved into receiving and respecting the spirit of Antichrist. And believing that that's God. And I would like to say it was done doctrinally through the Jesuit order under the Roman Catholic Church, which you probably know. And before I was off, this whole concept of one Antichrist was created by Loyola in the late 16th century. Loyola, along with Rivera, who wrote a 500-page commentary on Revelations. And there was 5 points that they said they would need to inbred within society, within the new Christianity, to deceive the people into actually accepting Satan as their Lord. One of them was they must reflect the people from understanding that it's a governmental institution that's against the Most High. So they created a one-man concept. Therefore, every other year they can pull up a boogeyman and say, well, is this the Antichrist? Is that the Antichrist? Why, the Antichrist agenda is being pushed through government. That was one. The second thing that they did was they said that we must make all Christians believe that there's going to be a third temple built in Israel for an Antichrist. Therefore, adding to the conspiracy of one man, when the Bible says there's many Antichrists. The whole focus I'm trying to say, and you can look it up under Loyola, the Jesuit, who came up with these concepts, which is embedded in modern-day Christianity today. And the example I can give you, and we know that the Catholic Church follow the fallen angels in Nephilim, and they give people a choice or make them think there's a divide between church and state, when the world's religion, the world governments are under a satanic religion. Every world government all. They're all. And how do we know this? And I'm maybe preaching to the choir, but I wanted to just explain to you a few things we've understood. When Christ was took to the top of, when he was taken to the top of the mountain and was shown all these kingdoms, and Satan told him, "I'll give you all these things if you bow down and worship me." Well, Christ did not. He didn't participate, okay? He denied. Matter of fact, he rebuked Christ at the pinnacle. But the Romans did not rebuke Christ. The Romans accepted the ideologies, and therefore Satan blessed them with his kingdom, if you want to call it that. All these kingdoms are set up under Satan, and they're hiding through doctrine. And they're using Christianity because Christ told us that many shall come in my name. That would be the main vehicle for the Antichrist teachings. And what we're trying to explain to brothers and sisters, no matter what denomination you're in, we have to get out of the theologian programming that was set up through the Jesuit order. There will be no one Antichrist. The mark of the beast, which we all know is being instituted, you were mentioning that earlier. They have the mark of the beast instituted within our society. They're imploding all the finances worldwide, not just America, moving everyone into a cashless society, and now through your Barack Obama, even though it's not his deal, he's just a puppet within himself. He's just a puppet. Just the president is just ceremonial more so than anything. In this new legislation, they have a two-way radio in which those that get this free health care, which is supposed to be national, will be required down the line to take a check. That's not just one man. That's not just one Antichrist. What we're trying to put out there is that we have to get away from the theologian doctrine and come to the truth of the Bible. Another point that I wanted to bring forth, and I was off for a minute, so there's a few things I wanted to say. Once we get out of that concept and understand what the true agenda of Satan was from the beginning, to destroy Adam, later on down the line, to destroy the children of Israel, in attempt to kill Christ, up to what you spoke of, Jacob's trouble, Jeremiah 30th chapter. One other key part of doctrine that the Catholic Church used was to teach people that Jacob don't exist no more, that Jacob is the church. When in fact,
replacement theology, yeah.
Exactly. They're replacing the children of Israel with spiritual people in which the prophecies are speaking of physical people out of the seed of Israel and not those who are in Israel today. So my point is, you are correct in all your, in the majority of your focus and your understanding of the Nephilim and what the world powers are planning to do. But all in all, even though many people will get caught up into this, their main focus is to destroy one bloodline out of the earth of the 12 tribes. And they have done testing. I have historical records. I have a lot of records to show you. They know exactly where the children of Israel are in the earth. And it would shock you. Probably wouldn't. All the people that they are aiming eugenics towards are Jacob. So because there's so many bloodlines within the earth that's caught up in the middle, they're going to fall through this, but their objective is to destroy the seed that bear the man-child. They're looking to destroy. They're over in Africa. And I'm going to tell you, brother, when we talk about Jacob's trouble, our church and what we believe in, we don't deal with dispensationalism and all that type of theology when it comes to tribulation. Our people have been in tribulation since we fell in 70 A.D. What I'm telling you and what we... the proclamation to the world is that the people that the European powers and the Roman powers came over to destroy in North America, South America, the people they took off the shores of Africa, these are all people who encompasses Jacob's trouble. Their aim is to destroy us, brother. And it's, that has been their aim the whole time. On top of that, they have used these governments and used our fortitude to build their empire their space stations and all their technology under Satan, who gave them this science, to get back into the heavenly throne to eventually try to fight the Most High, knowing that Christ will soon return. And we're reaching out and we're talking to people, because not too many people anywhere, not too many religions. I mean, Christianity and Islam is the same religion on both sides, two different languages.
Say that again.
I said Christianity and Islam is the same religion.
I would disagree with that.
I know you would. I know you would, but they are.
Well, Islam does not confess Jesus Christ as God.
But see, at least they're doing it openly. At least they are admitting that they're not worshiping Christ. The difference is Christianity, the infiltration of Christianity, is a deceptive religion altogether that has made people believe they are worshiping Christ, but they're not. That's what Christ warned us from. The only difference between Islam and Christianity is that at least Islam says they're not dealing with Christ. But let's go into theology, if you would like. Let's go into theology. When it comes to what the Most High said concerning his laws, Christians are saying it's done away with, it doesn't matter. They deal with Sunday worship, and Christ says, remember the Sabbath, keep it holy. They deal with Christmas, when that was a known Babylonian pagan worship before Christ was born. They deal with Easter, which was a known Babylonian satanic day of worship.
Have you ever heard of a term called sheik or shirk?
No, sir.
Okay, in Islam, shirk means to call God anything but God. And when one confesses Christ as God, in Islam, one commits shirk, and it's worthy of death. The whole Quran talks about beheading and neutralizing the unbeliever. And anyone who believes in Christ as God is considered an unbeliever and worthy of death. There's no way around getting around that in the Quran. So you cannot say that Muslim and Christianity are the same by any standard. They're not.
Okay. Do you know there's factions of Islam that believe in Christ?
They believe him to be a prophet, not God's son.
No,
not
I'm not talking
God.
About just a prophet. They believe in the return and that Christ is the Messiah. They're not taught that in the Western world. The same way there's non-denominational Christians who have awakened to the deception of Christianity, it's the same in
well, they wouldn't be they wouldn't be defined as a follower of the Quran then.
They're not
the Quran doesn't teach that.
Okay, let me give you an example. Let's just speak about Christianity real quick. We know that Islam is satanic, antichrist. Let's move that out of the way. Okay, let's just deal with Christianity as a whole. Okay? Because the biggest deception is not through Islam, because they're straight. They're coming straight. They don't believe in Christ. They don't believe that Christ is the Messiah in the overall concept of their religion. He's just a prophet.
They do not believe that Christ is God. They believe that he's a prophet. Exactly.
Okay, they believe he's a prophet, but they don't believe in his what the Christian church calls his divinity or
exactly.
his power, the Son of God.
And that's a great big difference.
Okay, that is a difference. But that's on the surface. And believe it or not, like I was saying earlier, Christianity is more deceptive because they're using Christ's name and claiming to be speaking the truth of Christ. But
well, you may be pointing to some of them, but they're not all that way.
Okay, so all
and the Bible... You have to define Christianity by those who follow and believe the Bible, just as you would define a Muslim by one who follows and believes the Quran. One is a Christian who follows and believes in Christ in the Bible.
Okay. Well, let me ask you what you believe, sir. Okay? do you believe that we should deal with Christmas, the holiday?
I don't think, I personally do not celebrate Christmas as a particular holiday.
Good. And you don't believe in Easter and celebrating that as a holiday, correct?
No, I don't particularly celebrate it as a holiday either, no.
Exactly. That's good. And you remember the Sabbath to keep it holy.
I think that Christians in the New Testament are not under a legalism, so I don't think that Saturday is a day more so special than any other day. So
okay.
We may disagree a little bit on that. Comes out of Colossians about keeping feasts and new moons and Sabbaths.
Okay. Let me open up my Bible if you don't mind.
Mm-hmm.
All right. Okay. Let's go to Acts, the second chapter, if you don't mind. I'm in Acts 2. I'm just here trying to share something with you just so that we can build together here. Acts 2. And when the day of Pentecost was fully come, they were all with one accord in one place. And suddenly there came a sound from heaven as of a rushing mighty wind, and it filled all the house where they were sitting. Right? This, the disciples, you know the whole story, right?
Mm-hmm.
The Holy Spirit came down, and they heard, Jews heard each other speaking their own tongue. Therefore, the gospel could be preached throughout the four corners of the earth during that time. All right? Because the testimony of Christ was understood throughout all these different languages. But in a nutshell, going back to the first verse, the day of Pentecost is when the disciples all came together in one place. We know the day of Pentecost, when you count seven Sabbaths from Passover, would be the first fruits, a holy day that was celebrated in the Old Testament, which we can agree, right?
And go ahead, I'm with you so far.
Exactly. So what I'm saying is, if the holy days and the Sabbath was done away with, the disciples wouldn't have came together on that holy day after Christ already died and resurrected. And this is not just the Acts of the disciples. This is all through the New Testament. I can show these actions. And not one place in the scriptures did it show that it switched to another day and that it wasn't significant. When it comes to Colossians, the second chapter, which you're speaking of, brother.
Mm-hmm. The 16th verse.
Uh-huh. Yes. When it says, judge no one according to those holy days and new moons. Why? Because under the old...
Or the Sabbath days.
Or the Sabbath day. Exactly. That scripture is correct, but the judgment according to the Old Testament was death. What Paul was letting the brothers know, that you're not going to come into this church and come into our union with that old doctrine of killing people. You're not going to come here. So the judgment was killing people. That's why he says, let no man judge. That wasn't telling people you're not supposed to follow what the Most High said. You're going to show grace and mercy and allow these people to find the Most High, literally, without force. And see, that goes into...
Well, the way I read that verse is that if a person wants to keep one day holy over another day, for instance, Saturday,
well, let's go
as a Sabbath,
see,
then we're not
really
supposed
to
judge
to them. Okay, I'm going to read it because we are not to add or put any other thing in to what's being said. Colossians.
Well, let's don't leave this. Let's talk about it a little more because it says, which are a shadow of things to come.
Absolutely.
Which means that the Sabbath was a shadow of things to come.
Absolutely. Absolutely.
So under the New Testament, where you have freedom from the law, there's no requirement to keep a Sabbath.
But do me a favor. Let's read the scripture because what you said, it's not in the scripture that we're reading. That's the point that I wanted to go here for. The scripture is clear, but what you're saying, including dealing with other days, it's nowhere in the scripture, is the point.
And then it says, let no man judge you according to the Sabbath days. Okay. Or keeping a feast or a holiday or a new moon.
Let me read it. It says, let no man therefore judge you. I'm in Colossians 2 and 16. In meat or in drink, for respect of an holy day, or of the new moon, and of the Sabbath day. These are all holy days of the Hebrews. This wasn't speaking of pagan days. Pagan days is not even a part of this conversation. These are all days. We can go into the Old Testament and show you days that if you didn't follow, it was worthy of death. But Christ, who died on the cross, who was death for us, took the death away. Therefore, because we know during Paul's time, they were looking to kill people and all that. You couldn't come into church and say, well, okay, it's time for me to pass judgment and start killing people up in here because they're not dealing with the holy days, the new moon, the Sabbath day. That's the true understanding of this scripture. It's not injecting days that are not spoken of in scripture. That's our point of the deception within Christianity. They inject things opposed to dealing with the scripture as it is written.
Well, now you just interjected coming in and killing people. I didn't read that in there. What I read is judge you in meat or drink or inspect of a holy day.
Well, I can show you a judgment to know what the judgment is, okay? By precepts. I get understanding, therefore I hate.
Well, let me ask you this. What you're saying is it's important to keep a Sabbath day. Is that correct?
Before I go there, let me read a judgment on one of those days so we can see what the judgment was according to precepts. And then I can answer that question. Numbers, the 15th chapter, tells us. I'm in Numbers 15 now. Okay? It says right here, Numbers 15 and 32. And while the children of Israel were in the wilderness, they found a man that gathered sticks upon the Sabbath day. And they that found him gathered sticks. Those that found him in the found him gathering sticks brought him into Moses and Aaron and unto all the congregation. And they put him in ward because it was not declared what should be done to him. And the Lord said unto Moses, the man shall be surely put to death. All the congregation shall stone him with stone without the camp. And the congregation bore him without the camp and stoned him with stone. And he died as the Lord commanded Moses. So that's the example we give of judgment. Of not following the holy days according to the Old Testament. And that was the script that Paul was dealing from. He was raised a Pharisee. So the whole point of judgment, we can't just say judging is telling somebody they shouldn't or should not do that. That's not judgment according to the Bible. Judgment of not following the Sabbath was death, which we can all agree now that we've read the precept. So if we rightly divide the word of truth, the Most High is not saying we're supposed to ignore him because there's no judgment right now. So Paul.
Well, I think what you're doing is you're reading something into the New Testament script that's not there. If you read that in the Message Bible, it says, so don't put up with anyone pressuring you in the details of diet, worship services, or holy days. All these things are mere shadows cast before what was to come, the substance is Christ. Don't tolerate people who try to run your life, ordering you to bow and scrape, et cetera, et cetera.
Sir, that's pagan overture. That have nothing to do with the scriptures when you look at the King James Version Bible. Okay?
You're trying to define judge, which is a New Testament word or Greek word in the New Testament, using an Old Testament.
What I'm doing is showing you that it's one book. They're all the same.
Well, what about David's men eating the showbread? What about Christ's disciples going through and picking the corn?
Yes.
Those are exceptions to the rule.
See, but those are not exceptions. And what Paul was and what Christ was showing there. As a matter of fact, let's go there.
Well, David's men eating the showbread were worthy of death. But what this New Testament scripture is talking about is not talking about killing people like what you're trying to say. You're bending that to suit what you want it to bend.
Okay, brother. But you are reflecting. Because the whole deal is, when you go to Matthew 5 and 17, Christ said with his own mouth.
Well, let's go back to this about the Koran versus the scripture. You like to talk about the scripture. There's vast differences in the Koran and the New Testament.
Okay. I'll go to the Koran, but let's make clear what Christ said in Matthew 5 and 17. Think not that I've come to destroy the law or the prophets. I've come not to destroy but to fulfill.
I'm familiar with that.
Exactly. So the whole deal is the Sabbath still stands. Even though we can't kill someone for not following it, we're not supposed to follow pagan holy days.
I didn't say you're supposed to follow pagan holy days, but I said that let no man judge you in your meat or drink or in Sabbath days. You're free in Christ.
Sir, a Sabbath day is a seventh day. It's not any day of the week. You don't define a Sabbath day by our own opinion. That's our issue with Christianity.
Okay, well, fine. It's the seventh day of the week, but it's still saying, therefore let no man judge you or despise you, and so to speak, in what you eat or drink or whether you keep the Sabbath day.
See, but those things were pertaining to the laws of eating and drinking along the laws contained in holidays, the holy days in the Bible. It never said that people can eat what they want and drink what they want. Those things go to precepts of Hebrews, is my point.
Well, the law was a shadow of things to come, and the body is of Christ. Why keep the shadows?
Exactly, because the shadow of things to come is the schoolmaster. And if you ignore the shadow, you don't understand what's coming. The law was our schoolmaster to bring us to Christ.
Was our schoolmaster, as it's mentioned in Hebrews, then Hebrews is talking about the fulfillment of the law in Christ and says that he nailed the law with himself upon the cross.
What law?
The Apostle Paul talked all throughout the epistles, and even in the book of Hebrews you find...
What law did he nail on the cross?
All of them.
Okay. All right. See, and that's why Christianity is where, that's why we are in this world where we are today. Because now, because of this, Christians have opened the door for just sin to run rampant. Because if you can...
Well, are you suggesting the Apostle Paul has opened a door for sin to run rampant requiring the church to keep the law?
Listen, Paul was fine, but you're not speaking true on Paul. I'm not talking about what Paul did. Paul was excellent in his work with Christ.
Well, Paul
I'm talking about the deception of how Christianity have used the misunderstanding of Paul's writings to teach paganism and Satan worship.
Well, Paul taught freedom from the law, but freedom from the law is not paganism.
No. Paul did not say anything that you're saying. Like when I go into the book of Colossians, and I would like to go back there, Paul was only speaking of the Hebrew laws. He wasn't speaking to let a pagan be a pagan and do whatever they wanted to. That scripture had nothing to do with that.
I agree with you totally. He was speaking of the Levitical law when he talked about holy days, new moons, and Sabbath days. Those were in Levitical law.
Also, the eating and drinking; those things were also in the Levitical
law.
That's
right. And they were shadows of things to come. They were schoolmasters.
Absolutely.
So it's not therefore necessary to keep those things.
And that's not true.
Well, that's what it's saying.
That's not what it's saying, and that's the deception in Christianity. Let me show you.
Well, I think we might just have to agree to disagree on this one.
Well, I'll tell you what. Let's agree with what Christ said, Matthew 5:17, because I can tell you the guy who came up with the mindset to use the misunderstanding of Paul's writing to try to trump what Christ said. And that was a conceptual, doctrinal, deceitful work within the Catholic Church. Matthew 5:17 says, "Think not that I've come to destroy the law or the prophets. I am not come to destroy, but to fulfill. For verily I say unto you, till heaven and earth pass, one jot or one tittle shall in no wise pass from the law, till all be fulfilled. Whosoever therefore shall break one of these least commandments, and shall teach men so, he shall be called the least in the kingdom of heaven. But whosoever shall do and teach them, the same shall be called great in the kingdom of heaven." That's Christ. And there was no variance between Christ and Paul. It's just that Paul's writings are hard to be understood for the unlearned, and therefore the pagans and the Jesuits use those misunderstandings to deceive the earth into believing that you can be lawless and through grace you can.
Well,
you know,
when you say lawless, you're referring to not keeping the Levitical law.
I'm the laws of God. I'm not talking about just the Levitical laws, because the laws were established before Levi.
The laws were established before Levi? Which
Absolutely.
Laws were they?
Let me read in Genesis.
You're talking about the Noahic laws.
Let me read in Genesis what was established before Levi, based on the content we're speaking of now, the conversation. Genesis 2:1, "Thus the heaven and the earth were finished, and all the host of them. And on the seventh day, God ended his work, which he had made. And he rested on the seventh day from all his work, which he had made. And God blessed the seventh day and sanctified it, because that in it he had rested from all his work, which God created and made." The Sabbath was established before the Levitical law. So if you even throw the Levitical law out the window, you still must acknowledge what the Most High established from the beginning.
Okay? I follow your point, but I think that I still think that Colossians covers that, but let's move on.
Okay, let's move on. Brother Gaja, is it Brother Gaja in, and we got the bar here?
Yeah, I'm still there.
Okay. All right, so, no, this is what I wanted to say real quick, and I had no idea we were going to talk about the Sabbath or the laws this evening. I just wanted to hear about the UFOs this evening. But all in all, I need brothers and sisters out there to really understand how if you open the door and say something is done away with, who's going to run through that door? And Christ, listen, even Paul told us, even Satan himself appears as an angel of light. He has ministers of darkness that are working who are claiming to be ministers of light. The Catholic Church did an evil thing by allowing us to believe that the Lord's Sabbath was done away with. Because now that we can say that, well, the law is done away with, look at the state of what's going on now in this earth. Look at in the Christian church how now you have homosexual pastors now. They're saying that, listen, they're under grace and that God loves them and you can't judge them. Now, this is rampant throughout the Western world now. So when you start opening that door of, well, the law is done away with, be ready for every lawless thing that's against mankind to get an institutional foothold in the Most High's work, or to try to destroy the work. So now a homosexual can say, well, you can't judge me. Hey, the New Testament, Paul, I'm a preacher now. Even though the laws in the New Testament and the Old Testament forbid that type of action. But, hey, you can't judge me.
All right, let's say that you're correct on all of this. All right, let's say that everything you're saying is correct. What my curiosity is the fact that you don't see much difference in Muslims and Christianity. You don't see much difference in the Quran and the Bible. I find that to be quite unsafe.
Let's make this clear. I see much difference between the Quran and the Bible. The Quran is nothing. The Bible is everything.
In the Quran, it talks about Allah and Muhammad being his prophet. It says there's no God but Allah, and Muhammad is his messenger. And that's directly opposed to Christianity, where it says, as you said, God said, I am that I am.
Well, again, when I'm saying conceptually, they're the same behind closed doors. You can't compare the Bible to the Quran. As a matter of fact, the Quran is total plagiarism with a spin in the 7th century to uphold.
Well, I'm glad to hear you say that.
Okay, yes, the Quran is total rubbish. Let me make it clear. I'm going to put it out there. Because there was no need, there was no Hebrew scripture, there would be no such thing as a Quran. But I'm saying the concepts, when you go around the people and operate around the people, I've lived around the people, and conceptually, it's the same belief. It's the same belief. They both believe that God's people are done away with and they don't matter anymore. Even, listen, I've looked at Muslims in the United States and went in the Middle East and seen Muslims and said, well, hold up, something is wrong here. They try to teach you that, okay, you're not to eat certain things in Islam. But yet, when you go to the Middle East, they're eating everything. You see pigs hanging, they eating everything that moves. They eat camel. When the Levitical law in Leviticus 11th chapter tell you clean and unclean food, what to eat, what not to eat. Now, I'm just using conceptually, they do the same thing. Christians will eat anything.
Ella Ricard.
Yes.
I just wanted to add something to that. Based on what the conversation that the caller was saying, our guest, C.K. Quarterman, was saying with the law, all right? And I'm just going to pull it out of the scriptures real quick. I'm in the book of 1 John, and I'm in the third chapter, right? And I'm going to read the fourth verse. All right, Mr. Quarterman, this chapter, I want you to have a look at it when you get a chance, all right? 1 John chapter 3.
You're talking about 1 John.
Yes, 1 John, not St. John. 1 John chapter 3, and I'm in the fourth verse.
Mm-hmm.
It says, whosoever committed sin transgresseth also the law, for sin is transgression of the law. Right? So, bringing it back around to the law, is that the law, if you break the law, you're sinning. Understand me? And that goes back to the law, like when Christ said, think not that I'm come to destroy the law. So I want you to have a look at that, because I see, you know, just based on talking to you, you seem like a nice person, and someone who's probably opened up to go into and have and examine the scriptures. You understand me? The point that we're trying to nail here is that Christianity has been tainted, but the scriptures, the Hebrew records still stand. So only in Christian philosophy will you find them telling you that the laws are done away with, where in the Bible it tells you straight that the Bible's, you know, right from the Old to the New Testament, that the laws still stand. And that's just the main point. You understand me? I see you saying going into the Quran and the Bible, but, you know, what Elder Rakar is saying is you know, the concept of Islam and the concept of Christianity is the same. Both of them dealing, you know, with Antichrist, you understand me? No, there are good people in both religion that go along with tradition and not knowing the root or the origin of what they're following. You understand me?
I understand the statement that you made, but that would mean that they were a bad Muslim if they didn't read the Quran and believe what it said and follow what it said. They'd actually be a bad Muslim.
Well, I tell you this,
now,
brother.
Bad Muslims might be good people.
Let me tell you something, right? I'm over in the UK, okay? And I go on the streets, and there's a lot of Muslims here where I am. Islam is a very big religion here, and I tell you this, a lot of Muslims don't read the Quran, don't even know what's in it. You understand me? I don't know where the idea comes from that Muslim people are reading Quran. They don't. A lot of them don't read. A lot of them don't even know what's in it. You understand me?
Why do they call themselves a Muslim then?
Because it's tradition. Just like a lot of us call ourselves Christian based on tradition. We see our parents do something and then we follow it and say that we're doing it. But a lot of Christians likewise don't read the Bible, because if they did, we wouldn't be here having this.
They'd be bad Christians then, wouldn't they?
Say again?
They would be poor or bad Christians.
Well, I would say go on.
No, go ahead.
I would say the majority of Christian people out there don't read the Bible. I'll put my hand up. The majority of them don't read it. And if they
I think it depends on where you're at, what area or what part of the country or what country you're talking to or about.
Well, sir, I've been around the world. I've been from the Caribbean to North America to the South America. I've been to Asia, Africa. You understand me? There's probably only one continent on this earth I've not been. You understand me?
I understand what you're saying. And that may be true worldwide, I live in what's called the Bible Belt.
Okay, then.
And there are a lot of people down here who do read the Bible. They have a lot of disagreements among themselves, but they read it.
But you're saying, okay, they read the Bible, but it clearly states in the Bible that we should follow the laws. And you're telling me that we shouldn't.
And we disagree with that. I think we're going to have to agree to disagree.
Okay.
It's like, I would like to say something, if you don't mind, Gotcha. I would like to say this. It's okay if we agree to disagree, not to follow the law. But if we're going to talk about Nephilim and all the evil that came into the earth, which is really interesting topics, why? They're interesting today because the Christian church have went so far from the truth that when you bring something that was mainstay knowledge during crisis time, it's a phenomenon. UFOs wasn't a big deal during crisis time or the Old Testament time or when Jude was speaking of Enoch. So I'm going to show you how it all ties in, brother. The fallen beings were lawless. And through this lawlessness, they have wrought all types of evil on mankind and degraded us to the point where we are today, because not that they had the power to. It was through persuasion and different levels of psychology and paganism that moved us into this world of disbelief. So all I'm saying is, if we're going to talk about the Nephilim and the disobedience that come with them, being the children of fallen angels who didn't obey God, and then on the other side say, well, the people who received a law in this earth to learn what was right from wrong need not follow a law, then eventually we will suffer the same punishments as the fallen ones we're speaking of. And that's all I'm saying. Those fallen ones with an agenda had an agenda to make us lawless too, to make us believe that those laws don't matter no more, and try to use Christ as a barrier between following the Most High and not following the Most High. And when I speak to Christians, and let me tell you, I was born in the Bible Belt. I was raised a Christian. I was raised in the Baptist Church. My grandfather was a Baptist minister. Okay? So I can attest to what Brother Gaja is saying, is that Christians believe and are faithful in their traditions and a lot in their values. But all in all, a lot of them don't know the Bible. Why? Because you cannot teach people according to the word not to follow the law. And Christ says, if you do...
Let's sort of cut to the chase here, gentlemen. You asked me on your show tonight, and I came on your show.
Yes.
Now, we agree on a lot of points. We agree that the 21st century church is corrupt. It's followed a lot of the ways of Babylon. But if you want me tonight to make some blanket statement that I think the New Testament church is under the law and should follow the law, I'm not going to do that today, and I'm not going to do that tomorrow, and I'm not going to do that the next day. So the best thing for us to do is either for me to depart the conversation or for us to move on in this conversation to something else.
Okay, sir. Well, let's move on.
That'll be fine.
Let's move on. Because the only reason I talked about that, brother, is to say that in these hard times, we have to find a way to come together under what the Most High needed us, wanted us to do from the beginning. We have to find.
Well, I think we both agree on holiness. I think we both agree that the highest calling in Christ is love. And I think that love for each other overshadows a lot of things and includes a lot of the legalisms of the law. But
okay.
Like I said, let's move on.
Let me just add to that to Mr. Quarterman. The reason why we kind of have to make a lot of things clear is because the listenership that we have is not necessarily just people who believe. A lot of our listeners are people who are searching for the truth, who are searching for an understanding, and you know it's very we should put it out there. What is our personal belief as to what in Scripture? Now, when you said just then, like when you just said, well, you would not change what you see today, tomorrow, or the day after, I appreciate that. Why? Because you're telling everyone there, it's on you. But we have to make everyone know what's in the Scripture. You understand me? You know, I was deceived a long time ago because of similar practices. People used to talk, say things that they believe, and it had no bearings on the Scripture. So, you know, I understand for people coming into the truth or coming into the understanding of the Bible, of the Creator, you know, coming into the understanding of Christ, that we have to kind of make it clear where everyone.
Well, you're being somewhat condescending about it, but let me just tell you this. That I don't think Christians should be put under law, under legalism. The Jewish people couldn't live under it. The New Testament church can't live under it. I don't think you need to be condescending about it. I'm well aware of why I believe what I believe, and we could have long conversations about it, and I could pull out as many scriptures one way or the other.
Well, sir,
so this is a matter where we disagree on small areas of doctrine, where the major doctrines are Christ and who he is.
Okay, and you know what? If I sounded condescending in any way, I apologize to you. But like I said to you, the listenership that we have here is very broad, and I want to take some callers in at the minute, real quick, because we're down to the last 38 minutes of the normal show before we go over into the overtime. Those of you who are listening online, now would be a good time for you to call in. I see Sister Charlotte here. I'm gonna bring her in real quick and hear what she has to say. She has a question and a comment. Hello?
Shalom, brothers. How are you doing?
Shalom, sister. How are you?
I'm good.
Bless you.
I'm good. I'm just, Elder Ricard, could you give an understanding of what 2 Timothy 3:16 is talking about? Because I'm under the impression that there's just a lot of word games being played around with in the scriptures, you know, and the word judgment, it appears that the minister, I didn't catch his name because I came in late, but it appears that he wants to stay stuck on that word judgment. You can't judge me, you know, but I think 2 Timothy 3:16 does explain that everything is inspired by the Most High. You know, and every word in the Bible is profitable for correction.
I agree with what you're saying. It says all Scripture is given by the inspiration of God and is profitable for doctrine, for reproof, for correction, for instruction in righteousness.
Could I just finish my point? Excuse me, sir. Could I just finish this, and then I'm going to just hang up. I mean, I'm just going to push one to get out the queue. But the fact that we often, believe that we're not under the law. Well, I suppose if we were perfect, then we wouldn't have to be under the law. But there's not any of us, you know, that doesn't fall short. of the glory, because if we walk in the Spirit, then the Spirit is going to guide us, and it's not going to cause us to, you know, continue to sin and err and, you know, not follow Sabbath. Because if you're walking in the Spirit, then the Spirit is going to guide you and lead you to keep the Sabbath, just as the Father said. And all through the New Testament, it continues to say that it is written, and where it was written, that was in the Old Testament. So I think that it's misleading on anybody's part to make people believe that the New Testament laws does not matter. Okay, and I understand what Elder McCall was saying, was that this is the reason why we're in the condition that we're in now today in the earth. I mean, everybody has their own laws, and I don't think that we could agree to disagree when it comes to the scriptures, because the Father says in Proverbs 3:5, do not lean to your own understanding. So if we're all interpreting the scriptures the way we want to or whatever, then how could the scriptures be profitable? And, you know, we just may as well put the Most High to the side if it's going to be that way. So I'm just going to push one, and I ask Elder to go over that 2 Timothy 3:16 for me and just kind of give me a clear understanding of exactly what that's talking about. And bless you, brothers, and thank you for bringing this show out. This lesson.
Well, bless you. And I don't have to say anything. I think you said it, and I'm sure it's well taken.
Okay.
So let's go to the next call.
Okay. Bless you.
All right. Bless you.
And
I also like to say we definitely want to hit up on this UFO situation. I want him to talk about his book again, because I'm definitely going to purchase this book. And I want to say that straight out. I'm going to purchase this book because he came out with some key information. And see, brothers and sisters, I'm going to say this right now. We don't need to throw out the baby with the bathwater, because all in all, we have to realize, brothers and sisters, that sometimes we just plant seeds, and then when we have to let the seed germinate and grow, the same way we were, all of us, at a certain point where the Most High showed us, but everyone is going to see in their own time. We just have to put it out there. With this book, he's putting out there what the Most High has showed him that's being ignored through mainstream. And I think that's great. Others may look at that the same way with debating certain points today and try to debate what's in his book and say, well, I agree to disagree. But if they sit there and focus on a few things with his book, I'm going to tell you right now, some seeds to be planted to have them look at the scriptures differently. And that goes into every area of doctrine. So I don't want to make it a thing where, which is, I'm glad he said, let's not even deal with that point, because right now he don't see it. He don't think he'll ever see it that way. That's fine. But let's stay open and still support the book, because the book is opening up things. Because if we can show Christians or anyone about the Nephilim and all those things, that will open up other questions. Well, if they lied to us about this purposely and are hiding these things, what else are they hiding? And I'm just speaking in general right now.
All right. That's a good point. And I don't think any of us have all of the light. I'm not going to sit here today and tell you that I have all understanding or all light on everything. I don't.
Yeah. Exactly, but right now you are where you are, and you're on the mission the Most High have you on. And it's whatever it is, it got us in this conversation tonight. So,
well, you know, well, I'd like to say this too, and you know, in connection with the UFO phenomena, it is the same phenomena that was going on in Genesis, the sixth chapter, and you know, we talk about the elephant in the church today, and one of the big elephants in the church today is the UFO abduction phenomena. There was a poll done on Facebook not too long ago, and 2.3 million Americans responded stating that they had been abducted. And since I've gotten into this, I've got 3 websites, I've talked to people all over the world, and the demonic activity is increasing. The darkness is increasing daily. And these things are going on in this UFO abduction phenomena, which are these fallen angels that are abducting women at night. And than coming back and getting them again. And the statistics show that. They're manipulating their sexual organs and so forth. It appears to be that they're harvesting fetuses of some sort. And this is the same thing that was going on in Genesis. If you stopped and you looked at Genesis, you'd have to ask yourself, how could a human give birth to a giant that's as tall as the cedars of Lebanon? Well, they couldn't unless they were taken out prematurely. So you've got this same kind of manipulation going on today under this guise of UFOs. And this is a terrible thing. This is horrendous. But we're told here in these last days that these things are going to happen again. We just need to know, you know, what it looks like. We need to know that aliens are fallen angels and demonic beings. We need to know that Christ said that they would increase in the latter days, and we've seen an increase of these things since 1948 when Israel became a nation. And we're going to continue to see an increase of this demonic activity. And I'm running into it all over this country and Canada. I've talked to people all the time that are having the most horrendous experiences happening to them. And that's the word I'm trying to get out, is that these things are happening. It just looks different today than it sounded like then. But it's the same thing.
Okay, and you're absolutely correct. And so let's put it quantify it into a way where we can get others to relate to this real quick. What brothers and sisters want to know, before we take the next call, what is government's role in covering this up? And how are they covering this up? Because these beings are over governments. So what is the government's role in this? And how have they been hiding this for so long? What type of tools they've been using to hide the fact?
I remember one of you made the mention earlier somewhere in a conversation a while back about technology. And fallen angels have always had technology. And of course in the last 6-10,000 years, they've done nothing but increase their technology. And I think they've struck a deal with the governments of this earth, and I think the governments of the world are deceived. They think they are actually working with aliens, when in reality they're working with fallen angels. But the carrot on the stick, if you would, is technology. And what they're portraying is a technology that the governments of this world want to get their hands on, and I think to some degree have gotten their hands on, and I think at some time disclosure of this will come out.
Okay, now I'm glad you brought that out, because I hear this all the time, and I'm in agreement, but I think that one of the spins that they try to put out there is that they believe they're aliens who can help us with technology, when we know through all these governments from the beginning that these people knew exactly what they were worshiping in the hierarchy of governments. They knew they were dealing with the rituals. Like, for instance, we have the Bohemian Grove in the United States,
San Francisco, yeah. Uh-huh.
Where our known leaders are worshiping Moloch and child sacrifice and all that. So these same, and you had that during the Mayans' time, where they had beheadings and sacrificing the children.
Well, I'm being kind when I say they're deceived. They may very well be knowledgeable of what they're dealing with.
Absolutely, they're knowledgeable. All right, but they'll try to put them out there, just throw out these, do a history show and throw out these open-ended questions. Could there be life on other planets? Could this be that? And they're funding the switch and bait.
Right. Mm-hmm.
You understand? The government
right.
of this earth know exactly what they're doing. Even in MKUltra, when they were taking children through UFOs and all that and taking them through portals and programming them to be used by government. This all intertwines into your book and the things that you're speaking of before the flood.
Mm-hmm.
But the whole deal is we have to bring it to the forefront and say, listen, we know exactly who you are and what you're doing, and we know you're trying to hide an ambiguity. We know you're trying to use these X-Files and these television shows and even the news programs.
Right. They're programming the public.
Exactly. To spin off
the extraterrestrial or satanic or demonic forces. Like, for instance, you may see a lot of children missing and think that it was just some rogue guy killing people, when really these are or children missing that are used for experiments, like you were mentioning. And then the news will play it off like, all right, someone is just missing.
Mm-hmm.
But no, we're actually living in a ritual.
That's true. I would agree there's a lot more of that that's going on than what we're being told. I don't hardly even watch the news anymore because I don't think it's accurate reporting.
No. It's spinning and programming people to believe into an alternative reality. We haven't seen reality yet in this world. And and the spin is so ridiculous to us because the reality is what we read, and they'll look at the book and say, oh, a bunch of fairy tales there, when that's more real than our alternative reality we're sold in this satanic world.
That's correct.
So it's a dichotomy. I mean, to know that they are sacrificing children. And see, you know, we don't like to attack religion, but without the programming of religion, of mainstream religion, the way it is today, they would not be able to operate. Okay? And I'm going to tell you, it's all encompassed into one big program towards destroying God's people. And
I'm hearing a lot more these days about sanctic ritual abuse than what I've ever heard before.
Hmm.
I don't know if you gentlemen have heard that term or not.
Yeah.
But I'm getting all kinds of information here and there, and people writing me about it and this type of thing. So it's getting to be even more common than it ever was before.
It's as if they're coming out in the open now, all the way out in the open, and revealing themselves, like you're saying, eventually. I don't think it'll be a thing where one day they'll just open it up where we have contacted extraterrestrial life. Maybe we'll get there, like you said, but I doubt that because the scriptures tell you they work in darkness. And the facade that they've put before us, the veil have worked so fine up until this time. The people are just seriously deceived and ready for destruction. I mean, let's take the next call. If you have some questions for the brother, please ask some questions on his book. Now, this thing goes all the way back. Even the Romans worshipped these same deities and powers. So did the Persians. So did ancient Babylon. It's like Satan go from empire to empire.
Mm-hmm.
And he, it's his Nimrod, and he constructs the same program at a different time. And a lot of us believe that our technology today is so great, when really the same technology was before the flood.
Research recently that stated that it's using mathematical statistics, which are above my pay grade, but stated that it was somewhere between 7 and 9 billion people that it was estimated to be on the earth before the flood. Now, we've only got about 6 or 7 billion people on the earth today. So that meant that the technology of the world before the flood was much greater than we ever imagined it was. And
exactly.
Yet they were destroyed.
Exactly. And to show and prove, the majority of our scientists and archaeologists that's in archaeology go back into old time to find information for modern-day science. Okay, so they make us believe, oh, that was old time. That's a long time ago. Look at our technology. Hey, that technology was greater and it was cleaner before the flood.
Right. There's a such thing called OPARTS, O-O-P-A-R-T-S.
Okay.
And
what is it? Let me write it down here. What is it?
OPARTS, O-O-P-A-R-T-S. And there's a small article on my website about it, but what it is out-of-place archaeological finds. In
okay.
other words, they found, like, in a coal stream, a stream of coal,
yeah.
which you know, it shouldn't be there, but they found a hammer, and that hammer had chlorine in the steel. Now, we can't do that today. And how did it get into a stream of coal? It had to have been prior to the flood.
Hmm.
So there's been other artifacts found like that. Some we don't even know what they were or are today.
Okay. And you have some of these findings on your particular website, correct?
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Sort of an interesting story on that.
Okay, great. All right, so let's open it up because I know we're winding down. I know a lot of people have questions. So I'm just going to sit back and ask your questions.
All right. Okay. We're going to go to the callers first. Let me say we got 20 minutes to the normal time of the show. And we're just going to try and get all the questions in that we as much as in as possible. Last week we had some technical problems in the studio. Let's hope we don't have it this week again. Okay, guys, we're down to the last 20 minutes. Now is a good time to start coming over into the call queue if you want to remain going into the overtime. The numbers to phone 646-200-4307. And we're in the Search Engine International. I'm your host, Brother Gaja. We have Elder Rakar. We also have C.K. Quarterman, which is the author of the book. Could you say the book again, please?
Fallen Angels, Giants, UFO Encounters, and the New World Order.
Okay. And the discussion has been very, very interesting thus far. All right, I'm going to go to the lines. I'm going to bring in Brother Lexwell. Let me get Brother Lexwell in. Brother Lexwell, are you there?
Yeah. Shalom, guys. How you doing?
I'm good, man. How are you?
Bless you, Shalom.
It's been a decent week, man. It's been a decent week. Hello, Elder Rakar. And
how are you,
hello to you too, Mr. Quarterman. How are you?
Well, I'm fine. Thank you.
Well, that's good. That's good. I just had a trip to the South this week, so it's a pleasure. It's a pleasure to get back and actually hear somebody. You are from the South, right?
Oh yeah. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, it's good. It's touching, you know, because of my trip. Okay, but hey, I had a couple questions for you. So in the beginning of the show, you brought up a lot of different books. So you're quite a advert studier. There, right?
I'd like to think that I've done a little bit of research, yes.
Well, and we talk about, when you talk about the days of Noah, I noticed that you bring up the Nephilim a lot, you know, and, you know, not to, you know, argue about doctrine or not, you know, I just assumed that more of the Nephilim existed in the days of Jared, just a little bit before. You know, in the days of Noah, I was noticing that they were doing more DNA splicing. And I say this because you said you read the book of Jashir. And I don't say this, you know, going off scripture alone, you know, because the scripture makes it towards, you know, to believe that it's more towards Noah's end. But, I mean, you know, when you read this... I mean, yeah, when you read this Jashir, it shows it's more towards the Nephilim, that is more towards Jared's end. So when I'm looking at chapter 4, verses 16 through 21, the end of the chapter, it's prior to the flood. It tends to go into DNA splicing.
Well, now, you're referring to the book of what you're saying, Joshua, Yesha, is what you're referring to, the DNA splicing. It's not actually mentioned in the Hebrew canon.
I'm sorry. You're saying Jashir, or you're...
Well, you're pronouncing it Jashir. Jashir is how most people would pronounce it.
That sounds like it's with Yesha. A Y. It's a little confusing.
Right, it is.
Okay, but when I look into chapter 4, verses 18, it says they're judges and they're rulers. Now, the interesting thing about the judges and the rulers, they express prior to that, that every man in chapter 17, every man made to himself a god. And it kind of implies that they crafted them by hand. And when you go up to chapter 16, it says they did this through evil practices. It says they took the fowls of the air and the beasts of the field and the cattle of the earth, and they made the mixture of animals into one species to provoke the Lord. And knowing that you write about this and the things that have been in the news lately, I was wondering where you see the world 5 years from now. We've just had news reports where there's babies that have been produced, been created in lab with three paternal parents, breaking the laws of creation. See, this is something that they were bringing up earlier, the importance of law. You know, the laws of creation, you know, man, woman, child, father, mother creates the son.
Right, not Adam and Eve, not Adam and Steve, yeah.
Right.
There were, just recently came out last year that there had been 150 experiments in England with cloning. So I think that we can agree that that's just the tip of the iceberg. How far this thing goes, I think it's going to depend on how much time we've got. You know, there are some writers who feel like the Nephilim are going to be created in the labs. I disagree. I think fornication is the way you get a Nephilim. But, you know, we could definitely be looking at some monstrous things coming out of labs. I don't think there's any question about that.
Can I ask you a question? Have you heard of Dr. Rosin, Dr. Joseph Rosin?
No, that doesn't ring a bell.
This is a doctor that says that he can graft wings onto a man. In 2006, he said he can graft wings onto a man within 5 years.
No, I hadn't heard that, but I know that we've grown ears on mice, so it's probably
this
possible.
Guy works at Dartmouth University. Okay, so in 2006, he announced in 5 years, which would have been last year, that he can surgically graft wings onto a man. Is there any chance you have a computer by you or just a notepad? I mean, with a computer, you can see exactly who I'm talking about. You can get a visual. I mean, there's quite a list of these doctors. When the BP toxic spill happened, there was a doctor, I believe Carter, that released a bio entity that could eat the oil and self-mutate itself, meaning recreate itself on a cellular level, meaning as more oil it eats, it grows. And this was released into the ocean, into our, you know, our ecosystem.
Right.
I
remember hearing something about that.
You know, I'm just trying to understand. You know, I haven't read your book. I tend to follow the church broadcast because there's only so much truth out there that's actually real. You know, we live in America, the great city of redefining everything in the definition of things. This is why there's so much confusion when we're looking at the same book. You know, when you see the 666 mark of the beast, What exactly does that mean for definition of you? Does that mean a computer chip, or does that mean DNA to you?
Well, I'm glad you asked that. We hadn't had a chance to talk about that. You remember earlier in the broadcast I mentioned that I saw the time of Jacob's trouble or the book of Revelation, the apocalypse,
right,
as being a very primitive time?
Right.
I don't see the 666 being an RFID chip. I don't think we'll have the technology going on then to make something like that work. I think that what it will actually do, I think it will be a something like a vaccine, some kind of an injection, which takes a minimal supply chain that will actually change the DNA of the person who takes it.
I agree. Excuse me.
Hold up, that's super, super deep.
Okay, but don't give me a time.
Let's, I ain't gonna cut you off. I'm gonna let you give your time. I gotta say something right here because this is cold blooded. Yeah, this is cold. Two things. Remember when they had a swine flu breakout? The CDC claimed it was a swine flu breakout, and they was testing the RFID chip so that with the RFID they would be able to monitor who has the particular diseases. And also saying that through time, with the injection, they would be able to, it would take over contraceptives and everything where they can control who have children and the mindset of people. There'll be no people working outside of the structure. All that news came out around the same time. Now, two things. Sir, just say hypothetically that the mark of the beast is what you're saying. If they did come out with mandatory RFID implementation, would you take it?
No, I would not. But one of the things I think is looked over many times among Christians is the fact that the actual mark of the beast won't come out until the middle of the tribulation. And it has certain descriptive facts. One is the people who take it are wishing that they could die, but yet they can't die. And there is no salvation for them. So, you know, this is all hypothetical injection here, so to speak, but if the DNA of a person were changed, then all of a sudden you have Lucifer or Satan who thinks he's winning the human race because he's changed it from something that it was. And Christ died for humanity, not for something of a changed DNA.
I'm saying, sir, I'm with you, but I can't emphasize enough that you need to look into the Jesuits' programming of the tribulation and teaching dispensationalism. I'm going to tell you, the tribulation only encompasses the fall of God's chosen people, which began in 70 AD. We're in the tribulation period. We've always been in, we were born into the tribulation period. See, and I'm saying this
that's a Pietrist view of it. Yeah, I'm familiar with the view.
Yeah, I'm saying this is because as long as we keep taking this view that it's future tense, we're going to ignore the key points of what we need to know now. And I'm with you. I'm just putting that out there. Just look into it because we're in it. It's about to happen. It's not future. And I'm saying this because I'm adamant with this particular understanding. But go ahead, Lex Will.
Okay.
One step, Brother Lex Will. We're down to 6 minutes of the normal time, guys. Now is the time for you to come over into the call queue. 6 minutes to go for normal time. Number to call 646-200-4309. Sorry, brother. Let's go ahead.
Now, last week we were cut off after the hour, so I don't know if that's going to happen right now. But if that happens, we would like to invite the brother back just for a question-answer segment for 30 minutes next week, just so that everybody's asking questions on this particular thing.
Yeah, that'll be fine.
Okay, great. All right, so go ahead.
Mr. Quarterman,
I have to make your point. I don't want to cut you off, but make your point, and we have to get to the next call, but make your point. I said I was going to give you some more time, but go ahead.
Mr. Quarterman, do you have your Bible by chance?
I've got one up on the screen.
You bring up Jacob's trouble, and I have to admit, from my studies, I see that Jacob is a bloodline. So can I ask you if you could expound on, if you could read and expound on Revelations chapter 2:9? Well,
right, I'm the seven churches and those who are the synagogue of Satan. I've just got to tell you, there are a lot of things about the book of Revelation that I just don't claim to know. I'm no expert in it, and I'm not sure I would be even qualified to give you a whole lot of explanation about that.
We're just two men. It's okay. Nobody's going to arrest us.
Hey, you know what, brother, man? I really respect the brother for that answer, you know? Really. Really. I really respect Mr. Quarterman for that answer, man. For that, you know, we have heard a lot of stories on Revelation. Some people like to go into. That's a very honest answer, and I really appreciate that.
And how about this? Can we look in the Book of Acts? Is that a fair book to look in, Mr. Quarterman?
Right, Acts.
About chapter 16.
All right.
Now, could you read this and expound on it for me?
The 16th chapter?
Verse 1. We don't have to go that far. I'm sorry.
Talks about, then came he to Derbe and Lystra, and behold, a certain disciple was there named Timotheus, the son of a certain woman, which was a Jewish and believed, but his father was a Greek. Is that what you're referring to?
Actually, no. I was actually going to go to Acts chapter 13. I'm sorry. That's even though that's in the same vein of what we were talking about, I said the wrong thing.
Now, in the church that there was at Antioch, certain prophets and teachers?
Yes.
Okay. What about that?
Can you continue, Barnabas and Simon?
And as they ministered to the Lord and fasted, the Holy Ghost said, separate me, Barnabas and Saul, for the work wherein I've called them.
Well, I wanted to talk about the part where they were described, because I'm not trying to expound on the Jewish part anymore. It's pointless. What I'm actually trying to expound on is the Jacob's trouble, because Jacob's trouble has to do with the DNA that's with the mark of the beast. Because in Jacob's trouble, he is poor, as he was prior to the kingdoms being started. Now, when it says here at Antioch, okay, this is naming a county, so to speak, in the church. Okay, there were certain prophets and teachers such as Barnabas and Simon. Now, if we go to Matthew chapter 10, Barnabas and Simon are two of the 12 disciples. Now, the people at the time, as I continue to read, they called them Niger. Now, the word Niger is Latin. Now, the Latin word Niger is the American word for nigger. Now, a point of Jacob's trouble is that the people of the world that are nationless at this point in time are called Jacob for a reason instead of Hebrew anymore. Because the people have been through slavery and they know not who they are. Now, the DNA that comes into play is the people that are in control.
Hold on, Brother Alexa, I don't want to cut you, but we're going over now into the blue room, all right? For the people that are in it, if you're not in it now, you won't be able to partake in the conversation any longer. Brother Alexa, due to the problems that we had last week, I don't want to get cut off.
Yes.
Again, like we did, so I'm going to ask if we can just take the next caller, yeah, and hopefully Mr. Quarterman 10 seconds to go, guys. 8, 7, 6. You know, go over. I don't know if you could just round up your points with Mr. Quarterman, and then hopefully next week we can, you know, we can take it further. All right, let's make a quick point, please.
Yes, sir. As we see, the people in Israel today have control of the Holy Land. They have the control of the DNA process. They have say over who can lay claim or who can't lay claim to being Israel. This scripture versus the scriptures of Revelation put together, 2 + 2. Do you see the connection of Jacob's trouble to the bloodline, the actual people who are of Hebrew origin?
Not in what we've read right there at all. I'd have to say I was totally blank.
Okay, Brother Lexwell, we'll have to take the next caller real quick and get back to that one. All right, and Mr. Quartman, I'll follow up on a little bit as to what Brother Lexwell here is saying. Okay.
Thank you, Shalom. Mm-hmm.
Okay, man. Shalom. Thank you for calling. What he's saying is that Brother Lexwell is asking the question: can you see a connection in Jacob's trouble with any particular set of people on this earth today, as opposed to the ones who are in the Middle East, you know, claiming to be Jacob?
I would say that again, I think Israel is Israel. You know, are there Jews that are outside of Israel? Certainly, but I think that, you know, there's also where God talks about bringing home all of the tribes of Israel.
Okay.
So I tend to think that when God's referring to the time of Jacob's trouble, he's referring to the nation of Israel as we see it today.
Okay. All right. Let me just bring our next caller. We have Brother Greg with a question and comment.
Hey, how you doing? Shalom, my brothers.
Shalom.
Hello. I'm going to get straight to the point because a lot of people have been taking up time, so I'm just going to read a scripture. I'm going to get back on the UFO thing because it's going to all glue it back together, as I see Brother McCall was trying to do. I'm going to read Zechariah chapter 5, verse 5. Then the angel that walked with me went forth and said unto me, lift up now thy eyes and see what this that goes forth. And I said, what is it? And she said, this is the ephod that goes forth. He says, moreover, this is their resemblance to all the earth. And behold, there was lifted up a talent of lead. And this is a woman that sitteth in the midst of the ephod. And he said, this is wickedness. And he cast it into the midst of the ephod, and he cast a weight of lead upon the mouth thereof. Then he lifted I up my eyes, and looked, and behold, there came out two women, and the wings were in their wings, for they had wings like the wings of a stork. And they lifted up the ephod between the earth and the heavens. And then said I to the angel that talked with me, whether does these bear the ephod? And he said unto me, to build it an house in the land of Shinar, and it shall be established and set there upon her own base. So when we deal with these UFO things, we don't have to guess anymore what they are and where they come from. They're coming from the woman who is Esther, who sat on the throne, or sat in Babylon with Nimrod for rulership. And these ships came down and dealt with men in Shinar and made a base. So when Nimrod had the technology and understanding to build a tower into heaven to fight against the Most High, this is the technology given to us by the fallen angel who bear the Nephilim, the giants, who stood the sails, who stood animals and mixed animals and made dinosaurs. Because if we understand that correctly, we know the sins of Adam brought about death. So we know dinosaurs cannot have been eaten other animals before Adam was born, because Adam brought about death through his sin. And I just wanted to tie that together, because now we know sin is transgression of the law. So we know by not keeping the law, we're transgressing against the law of the Most High that was given to Adam and his descendants, who are the children of Israel, who are Niger. And that's what we're trying to get you to understand, that all of this ties together through your governments that made the deal in Babylon under Nimrod when all the nations worshipped him.
Brother Greg. Wow,
yes.
I see you on fire, man. Sorry, man. I don't mean to cut you, man, but I need to move on to the other caller.
Okay, yes. I'm sorry. I just wanted to know what the brother feel about that passage in the scripture. That's all I needed to understand.
Okay, Brother Greg. Thank you very much for calling in, man. Hopefully, we can do this again at the beginning of the next show next week for the first half an hour. Okay.
Oh, okay. Excellent.
All right. Thank you for calling.
Okay.
Wow.
All right, Gaja.
Yes, sir.
I wanted to say this so that, you know, we can tie all this in. In a nutshell, I think, because I know he's probably totally in the dark of what's going on with some of these calls to some degree. In a nutshell, brother, you on the show, and I apologize if you don't know exactly why people are going certain places. The majority of people in this listenership realize to some degree not only the deception of what the media is speaking of with the UFOs and so on and so forth, and hiding their true intent. They're also hiding the people whom they're directing their destruction towards. And they're using religion and other areas to hide the fact that the true children of Israel are in the earth and have been suffering tribulation for a long time. So that's why they're going into these scriptures showing you that the disciples were black, the people of the Bible were of color, and he's going into Revelation to show, even in Revelation 7, it tell you about the 12,000 men from each tribe that had the seal of God, that the tribulation is actually aimed towards destroying God's people. And the Romans began that destruction in 70 A.D. And then after that, they assumed an identity under Caesarea and changed themselves by converting into Judaism and got political power over the earth today. And that's what a lot of the brothers and sisters who are in this call in the queue today are speaking of, because those that control the earth today, their finances and the agendas of the world, know about these UFOs, and they are working with Satan. So when he went into the scripture, Revelations 2 and 9, I know the blasphemy of them which say they are Jews and are not, but are the synagogues of Satan. These are people in the earth with an agenda to destroy God's people. And we need to make the world aware of this satanic plot. That
now, when you're referring to God's people, are you referring to black people? Is that what I gather that you're saying?
Well, not black people in general, you understand, because you have other people who are not black, who are from the diaspora of the 12 tribes. But the people in Israel are not the people at all.
Okay, so that's the point, is that you're saying,
yes,
Zionism, or those who are in Israel now, are not actually Jews.
Exactly. They're actually assuming a position and hiding their true identity while attacking the bloodline they know who are Israel. And they're doing this through religion, and they're doing this through their modern-day system. But their objective is the same objective as the ancient Romans when they destroyed Israel in 70 A.D. It's the same agenda. Satan didn't change his agenda.
Yeah. Well, it might be. It might. I think we probably covered most of the questions. I probably don't think I need to come on next week, because I'm not sure we'd really have agreement with that. I think the nation of Israel was raised up by God today to be the nation of Israel. Now, I can't say that every Jew or every person in Israel, you know, isn't Israeli or a Jew, by no means, but I've been there. And I think the nation of Israel is what's spoken of in the Bible, and I support it. And I'd support it 100%.
Well, okay, but the whole issue we have with that is there was 12 tribes of Israel. And the European Khazars, who converted into Judaism during the time between the 8th and 11th century, links to the people that are over there today, and they won't let us know which tribe they're from.
Well, I don't think that there's a modern means to know, except for the Kohan gene that they've been able to determine is the priestly tribe, that I have read anything about.
Okay, so they can't identify anybody else but who?
The priestly tribe. They found a gene from the priestly tribe called the Kohan gene.
Okay. Those who call themselves Cohen.
Right.
Okay. So, well, really, you probably not even, this is not even your field, so I'm not even going to go there with you. But in a nutshell, what they were speaking of is the fact that there is history. Maybe you need to pick up a book also to add to your the rest of your list, like the 13th Tribe by Arthur Koestler, who give you the research of where these people in Israel really come from. They're not from the priestly Levitical priesthood. As a matter of fact, we had one on last week who realized that he'd been lied to also.
There is even a British Israelism where the Worldwide Church of God feels like that Israel was Britain and modern America are the Israelis.
Yeah, but that's utterly ridiculous. How can a landmass be a people?
Well, I didn't say it was true. I just said that,
so
you know, modern,
all types of philosophy.
There's a lot of takes
there
on that idea.
Yeah. It's a lot of takes, but the Bible distinctly tells you who the children of Israel are based on the curses they would suffer. If we're talking about tribulation and Jacob's trouble, which is tribulation, we ought to know who Jacob is, so we'll know where we are in prophecy. So that's a whole other conversation in itself, but I think that if you were to research that, it'll help you out with this connection with the UFOs also, because they have their hand in the whole construct we're speaking of right now.
Mm-hmm.
It's impossible for these governments to be established under Satan and not have an idea of who they're working for and what they're setting up. And that's including the new founded state of Israel, which is really Roman. That's why they're ruled by the Club of Rome, the 300 men that's ruling from Europe. So that's why people are asking you questions, because you're hitting on some key points that should lead you to some of the culprits who are helping these demonic forces. You understand?
Well, I have heard some of what you mentioned earlier about the Club of Rome and these types of things. I mean, I have heard of them.
Yeah. And, you know,
but it's not my
Rome,
area of expertise by no means.
But you know, they're set up predominantly under the they are Roman families, but all in all, the majority of them are Jewish. So how can the Club of Rome be Jewish when the Romans destroyed the Jews? See, we're pulling these things out because if Christ and the disciples were here today, they would be speaking the truth, so that we can actually uncover or really expose the lies that have deceived God's church. And we would also be able to operate and understand who the children of Israel are in the earth today.
But in so doing, you destroy the modern nation of Israel.
Well, no, I wouldn't destroy the modern nation of Israel. Israel is to be established by our Messiah. I have nothing to do with what they're dealing with over there. They are fulfilling the prophecies of making the land desolate. And
so
they are
an abomination. We would disagree with all of that.
Yeah. We totally disagree with that.
Alorica, Mr. Quarterman, and all the listeners are tuned in. We have 5 minutes left for the show before we get cut off. All right. I'd like to thank Mr. Quarterman for coming in. And I'm sorry for not being able to answer all the questions down the line. But Mr. Quarterman, would you say, would you come back next week for a question and answer segment? No? Yes?
I'll send you. How about let's email each other on that? I need to check my calendar.
Okay, then. All right. But, you know, I'd like to say on behalf of myself and the listeners that we're happy that you came on. We're happy that you took time out for us to have the discussion, have the talk with us. And,
well, thank you for having me. I appreciate that.
Yeah, it's been enlightening you coming on, and I hope that for the future that we can see some common ground. I'm going to go and have a look at your book. I'm going to definitely keep in contact with you via the emails and the calls.
All righty.
Okay?
Thank you so much.
Okay. Bless you, brother.
All right. Y'all too. Bye now.
All right. I'm glad that happened because the brother was honest with his education based on what he known. But one thing I wanted to point out, and I think Lex will hit it home, is that you notice how they usually come on with all levels of high understanding that the Christian church haven't told the people, but they're not willing to point to the culprits who are operating with the satanic agenda. And I hope everyone can see that. And they're not willing to admit that they talk about Jacob's trouble, but then muddy the waters when we start speaking of when we start showing exactly who Jacob is in the earth. And brothers and sisters, that's on purpose.
Just a mole if he'd...
Hello? Are you with me?
Yes, I'm here. I'm sorry. That was my
okay.
Side.
No, what I'm saying is that's a purpose action. A lot of these people know exactly what's going on. Just like he said, he's going through all this UFO stuff and what's going on, and he knows that the majority of technology, ingenuity, and science is backed by those in Israel. So how can he know that they're connected with the Nephilim and fallen angels and those that oppose the Most High in Christ? And he knew exactly what was going on in Revelations 2 and 9 of those who say they are Jews. And you notice he said, well, I support the state of Israel. This ain't about whether or not you support the state of Israel. Do you support the truth of Christ? Do you support Christ? And they want to talk about a tribulation that's not going to happen. And listen, happen. We've been suffering tribulation since we fell. You think the slave ship wasn't tribulation? You being whipped and family being separated, was that tribulation? You mean to tell me we got to wait for something worse than that? We in tribulation. And I know that he's not doing this purpose because that's how he's taught. I don't see no deception purposely within this brother. I just think that he's dealing in an arena in trying to compartmentalize that his concepts without looking at the big picture. And it's a shame because if he can see that much, you have to tie in, like he said, that he tried to make it seem like the government just believed that there's aliens. He know that the government don't believe that. When I brought in the Bohemian Grove and the sacrifice and the rituals of Moloch, even back during the time of the Mayans, where they were beheading their children and sacrificing people to the fallen angels, children, with UFOs. So if he have tied this together, you cannot go into UFO and abductions and all those things and not see that there's a government conspiracy. You cannot separate the governments of this earth from what happened before the flood, because the fallen angels were operating with the hierarchy of government, the hierarchy of government. And that's the points we wanted to make here. And I'm glad a lot of brothers and sisters are learned enough to come straight to the point, like the other brother who came in and brought out Zechariah. They don't expect our people to know these things. You understand? But that speaks to the Most High. Even when his sister called in, and she cut right through and say, listen, there's no disagreement if we believe in the Most High. And some people might ask, well, what do we do? Are we and bringing people in that bring forth?
Elder Ricard, you're breaking up, brother. I don't know, Brother Gadget, I don't know if you hear me or you hear the elder. For my end, he's Brother Gadget?
Elder Gabar, I'm hearing you clearly. It was Elder Ricard's line was coming a bit crackly again.
Yeah.
Yes, well, I'm hearing you clearly.
Okay. and also, I want to make a quick announcement for those who are listening. They are in the Hebrew Academy. I apologize for the last 2 weeks. in regards to the quiz. Going forward, we are going to be doing the quiz every Thursday at 7 o'clock Eastern, 7 o'clock p.m. Eastern. Tomorrow, we're going to go over quiz number 3 and 1. And next week, we'll be going over quiz number 4 and 2. It will be follow up. We'll be up, you know, we'll be caught up with all the quiz. So tomorrow, we'll do 3 and 1. Next week, will be 4 and 2. Okay, let me see if I could get in Elder Ricard back in here. Elder Ricard. Okay. Yeah, for some reason, Brother Gadget, it would probably be best just to cut it down until I got to call customer service. She was going on with either they're in or something that we're doing wrong. For some reason, we've been having these type of issues after the overtime. So it's probably be best to going forward to do it for 3.
I think okay, is this okay?
Are you back? Okay, yes. You're coming in loud and clear.
Yes, I'm good now.
Okay.
Okay. Okay, I'm good now. I just wanted to say that, and thank you, that brothers and sisters are pretty sharp to see that there's a lot of educated people out there who are in the Bible who try to bring forth certain points, but they don't want to admit the truth. They don't want to admit that the children of Israel are people of color. They don't want to admit that Jacob's trouble is speaking of the people of the Bible. How can these religions be reading a Hebrew book and not relate the prophecies in a Hebrew book to the Hebrews? Is everything okay there?
Sorry, my computer's acting up. I apologize to the listeners out there.
Okay, all right. Yeah, this thing is all over the place right now. But I would like to say that there's key points, brothers and sisters, that there's a common ground every time we have these discussions. That usually the disagreement come in when the truth comes out of the deception and the deceivers, and on top of that, when we start bringing forth prophecy concerning our people. That's where the disagreements usually come in. So we have a few people in overtime. Let's open up the line. Let's hear what they have to say.
Okay.
For those that are still cute.
Okay, then. Brother, is it Rafa? Brother Ruffus, question or comment?
Yeah, hello?
Hello.
Welcome. Can you hear me?
Yeah, you break it up, though.
Okay, wait, hold on for a minute. Hold on, let me take it up. Hello, can you hear me now?
Yeah, I'm hearing you now. Question or comment?
Oh, yeah, I just had a comment. First of all, shalom, my brother, Brother Gosh, Elder Carr, and Brother Gabar. Yeah, I had it basically pertaining to what the guest was talking about, dealing with the law earlier. I had just wanted to share a scripture, coming out of Romans chapter 8, because earlier, I understand the way I wanted to bring forth is that, when Paul was, when they don't understand what pertains to the law is that when Paul was talking about law, sometimes when he's talking about we're no longer under the law, we're no longer bound by the law, he's talking about the law of sin and death. And so I had one scripture come out of...
Brother Ruffers, I don't mean to cut you, but can we keep it down to like a minute and a half, 2 minutes, please?
Okay. I'll just share this one scripture and that'll be it.
All right, thank you.
Where it says, Romans, I'm starting from the first verse. There is therefore now no condemnation to them which are in Christ, Christ Yeshua, who walk not after the flesh, but after the Spirit. For the law of the Spirit, of life in Christ Yeshua, has made me free from the law of sin and death. That's a scripture I wanted to bring forth. So he's not, and plus he said something earlier about where the Jews couldn't keep the law. Well, in the Old Testament, that's because, he couldn't keep it, it's because they were there with the flesh. So let me read the third verse. For what the law could not do in that it was weak through the flesh, God, most high power sent his own son in a likeness of sinful flesh, and for the sin condemned sin in the flesh, that the righteousness of the law might be fulfilled in us who walk not after the flesh, but after the Spirit. So that's the point I wanted to bring forth. Because that's why Christ had to come, you know, to show us how to follow the law in the Spirit. That's why they couldn't follow the law in the Old Testament, because they were dealing with the flesh. So it's just like, you know, the law was a schoolmaster, but it's just like in Christ was college. But when you graduate from high school to college, you don't unlearn what you was taught in high school. You apply what you was taught in high school to college. So that's why I just wanted to bring forth. So,
yeah, man.
So we got
to
follow. Yeah.
Yeah, man. Thank you for that, man. Thank you for that, brother. Thank you for that. That was really good. That. Yeah.
Okay.
You know, sorry to be rushing you, man, but we just want to get in as many callers as we can. You know, we don't want it to cut off on us like it did last week.
Okay, I understand.
All right, man. Thank you very much, sir.
Okay.
We're gonna go to Dominic with a question.
Yes. Hi. My name is Dominic. I had a point to make on the law. The gentleman who was there earlier said that the Jews could not keep the law. He said that nobody could. But we have an example of a people that kept the law in history. And in fact, we have many examples. Most indigenous people would fall into that category. In the book of Esdras, we learned that that the children of Israel were determined to go to a land that they could keep their commandments. And in the book of Hosea, we read that the children of Israel would number as the sands of the sea, would number into the billions. And the prophets have said that only a remnant is left. Well, we have to begin to ask ourselves, where was the billions that the father said that the children of Israel would have turned into? And in fact, we did turn into billions. And when Columbus came to America, that's what he found. When they went to the west coast of Africa, that's what they found. They found those people obeying the law, those people obeying every single last one of the commandments of God, and that's why they multiplied into the billions. If you use the rule of 70 and go backward, you'll find that Columbus found over 2 billion people in the Americas before it was ravaged and destroyed. Now, my question is that FEMA and some of these organizations are funding Christian churches to educate the public on some of the horrors that are coming. Now, I happen to think that they are gaining the confidence of the people in order to lead the sheep into the slaughterhouse. And I wanted you to comment on that.
Hey, Elder Rakai.
Hey, you are 100% correct. And that makes it more important that we, on this side, awaken our people to what's coming. The fact that we are going into the end of our tribulation that's aimed towards our destruction, we need to more so let the children of Israel know exactly who they are throughout the four corners of the earth. It doesn't matter what they believe. If they are from the seed or the stock of Israel through bloodline, the Illuminist powers under Satan and the Roman Empire, who is really the Jewish powers today, are looking to kill them exponentially all over the earth. So this is a physical thing, too. And that's what we're trying to put out there. You are absolutely correct. It's physical. They have a directive. They understand exactly who they're looking to destroy. And they're using the church, the Christian church, that's aimed towards so-called missionary to convert God's people all over the earth into this religion of making them believe they're done away with, while the Roman powers are looking to destroy them off the earth altogether, like Daniel spoke, the desolation of abomination. You are right on. That's all I have to say, brother. You are right on point.
And before I take the next caller, I'm going to read Deuteronomy 28 and 45. It says, moreover, all these curses shall come upon thee and shall pursue thee and overtake thee till thou be destroyed, because thou hearkenest not unto the voice of the Lord thy power to keep his commandment and his statute which he commanded thee. So that's why they got destroyed. The Indians, those of us who were taken from the west coast of Africa, yo, yeah, that's why, you know, that's why we got destroyed. That's just to add to what Brother Dominic was saying.
And before you get to the next call, Gaja, that's why we need to do a show aimed towards just surrounding. Why is everyone so adamant against acknowledging the true children of Israel? We need to open up a show and invite some people on and ask, why through all doctrines y'all adamant into denying that the black people and the people of color and the indigenous people of North, Central, and South America and the people in Africa, why is it that you're adamant against teaching that these are the children of Israel?
Well, Elder Rakai, if you noticed before, the guest we had, he was quite happy to come onto the show next week to answer questions. Until you came and made the point clear why the callers were going in the way they were going in on him.
Exactly.
So it changed the whole song, the whole tune changed to from I can come in next week to the point that we just contact each other via email. That's a no for me. I'm not coming back, but we can talk via the email. Likewise,
he switched instantaneously.
Yes.
When he realized that we were talking about who the true Jews were.
Yes.
So he's a smart man. So obviously he do know more than what he's letting on.
Yes.
Because this wasn't even about supporting or not supporting Israel. This is about pointing out the people of Jacob's trouble. Who are these people? You talking about Jacob's trouble and don't want to talk about who Jacob is? when is it in the scriptures that Jacob, in the end days, will be ruling the whole earth and give power to the EU and be in collusion with Babylon? Where is that in the scripture? When the last days, the children of Israel will be established as a superpower under Satan's kingdom with nuclear weapons. Where is that? And see, I'm going to tell you, some people ask, and they always ask, well, what difference does it make? It's not really important. That is the key. Let me tell you, that's the skeleton key right there. You break the code of who the children of Israel are, you understand all prophecy, because the whole Bible is surrounded around the prophecies of a people that came out of Egypt until they rise again under the promise given to their father Abraham through Christ. The whole Bible encompasses prophecies concerning these particular people. You going to tell me it doesn't matter who they are? So we need to get some people on the line. We need to get a conversation going just strictly on why the doctrine all over the earth, how can I put this? Why does all doctrine deny the true children of Israel? The people of color. Why do they deny that the children of Israel were and are people of color? Why? We need a show on that.
Well, you know what? I think we need someone on the show, with that who has the history of the Khazarian convert, the empire, the Khazarian empire, so they can then speak and tell you straight up, saying, listen, those people are converts. You understand me? Rather than,
you know what? In order to do that, guys, we're gonna need to do a complete show on the Holocaust. We gotta break this thing down piece by piece. We have to go backwards piece by piece. We need some people, some historians of the Holocaust to come on the show to show you that that whole thing was propaganda to switch the whole Israel movement. To give them power without pushback. We need to get some Holocaust people on, some Holocaust historians, some people that's willing to speak the truth, and move this thing all the way back, because I'm going to tell you, man, these people, these powers that be that's over in Israel today, they have played us very close. They've played us close. They've been watching whether or not we would awaken. And now that we're at the point of understanding who we are, and we're looking at them now. They're right next to us because they played us close. They're saying, well, okay, we got the armies, we got the UN armies, let's kill them now. So we have to put this out there. The skeleton key to this whole thing is breaking down who the children of Israel is and this so-called bloodline battle in which society is not willing to admit exists. Mm-hmm. There's a bloodline battle here. You can't tell me there's a bloodline battle. They didn't go to China to put people on slave ships and bring them to America. Okay? So, I mean, come on, man. Can everyone see that this was a directive? This was an actual plan? So the key, and that's why they don't like us breaking down who the children of Israel are. He came out and said, well, what you saying? Israel is black? Well, what are you saying? Israel is white?
Oh, my. Listen.
Then he said, oh, okay, I don't think I'll be on the show next week.
Yeah,
of course.
I'll
be on the show because truth is being spoken, and we actually let you know who those fallen angels are running right now. They're running Israel.
You know what, though? What is good? What is good about what's going on here is that these shows are being archived, and they're actually being going back. People actually going back and listening to them. So when he diverts off the topic, like for example, when Brother Lexwell brought the scripture to him, Acts 13:1, he skipped right over the word Niger, and went to
So that tells you guys.
Yep.
That he must know something if he know what to omit.
Yeah. Totally omit that. Ella, let's take another caller before the time goes down on us. I'm gonna bring in Brother Rai.
Hey, shalom, brothers. Can you hear me?
Clearly. How you doing?
I'm doing fine. I wanted to bring out some scriptures when the brother was on about dealing with Colossians 2:16, and I had a couple of points I wanted to, I wanted him to expound on that. Maybe Elder Ricard, you can expound on dealing with UFOs. But dealing with Colossians 2:16, I was going to ask him to explain, based on his understanding of Colossians 2:16, if he could explain Isaiah 66:15-17. And then down to verse 24, I believe. But when he said that, you know, therefore judge no man in food or in drink.
Hold on, brother. Is it Brother Rye, right?
Yes.
Yeah, man. Let's keep. Can we keep it down to like 2 minutes, please?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Yeah. Sorry, man.
Yeah, no problem. But in Isaiah 66:17, it tells you that when Christ comes back, those eating swine's flesh and abomination and things of that nature will be consumed together, thus says the Most High. So if Colossians 2:16 is saying that you can eat or drink whatever you want to drink, then what is this prophecy that's talking about in Isaiah 66:15? And then verse 23, when it talks in verse, when you parallel Colossians 2:17, we talk about the shadow of things to come. In Isaiah 66:23, it goes into, and it says, and it shall come to pass that from one new moon to another, and from one Sabbath to another, shall all fish come and worship before me, said the Most High. So this is the shadow of things to come, and we do what we pray, that the Most High will be done on earth as it is in heaven. So I kind of want him to explain that. And then what I want, hopefully you can expound on dealing with the UFOs, is the understanding that dealing with the demonic relation between UFOs and the great deception, as far as Satan and the government using UFOs to deceive people into doing war against Christ when he returns. And if you had any, you can expound on that whole aspect of UFOs and the purpose of them using disguise and demons as aliens, opposed to something else.
Well, first of all, you was correct. The shadow of things to come is following the law, but the law will be in our hearts. That's the shadow of things to come, that we will follow the law. See, but when he went into Colossians, I understood what he was doing. He wasn't going into Colossians to bring forth understanding. He was going into Colossians for others who may read that scripture and be deceived of what Paul was actually speaking of. And that's why I went into the conceptual, the concepts that he was talking claiming that Colossians was saying the law or the holy days of judging people is actually speaking against, if you speak against their Christmas or speak against their Easter or Sunday worship, that you're breaking Colossians, the second chapter. So I wanted to break him down to show him that his concept of that scripture was totally incorrect, because pagan holidays wasn't even part of that scripture. It was talking about judging people according to breaking the holy days of the Hebrews. So that's why I wanted to stay there. But the shadow of things to come are correct. We will follow the law in the future. And according to what you've just read, you're going to have one eating swine's flesh behind a tree, and they're going to be killed when Christ returns for eating swine. So that's the shadow of things to come. So we can't judge, but Christ will judge. That's the key, and that's a good point you made. The other point you was mentioning, of you were asking why they're trying to hide it under the ambiguity of UFOs. Gotcha. Is he on or?
No, he's not on. I was gonna move on.
Okay. Yeah. So he was asking about the UFOs and why they're trying to hide the true identity of it, and why they're trying to hide it by claiming it's UFOs and not saying that it's really demons and the children of fallen angels. Well, it's clear why they're doing this, because if they told people that they were fallen angels and demons, people would believe in Christ. People would now go back to the scriptures, they would go back to the Bible to understand what is this warfare against these demons and what are their presence are so public for. Really, these alien programs are an actual introduction of demonic forces into our lives. That's what it is. And you're looking at these alien movies and we're endearing ourselves to E.T., phone, home, and all this garbage. And they're really introducing demonic forces into our life. They're showing you what they've been dealing with the whole time. So that's why they use the alien. But when you look at the word Alayan, that goes to the word gods or powers, or one god or power also. Alayan. So that's a Hebrew word that talks about a fallen god. So they're telling you in plain view that it's alien, that it's a Hebrew god. But they're saying it in a way in which it's like a play on words. We think alien means something foreign or something distant, when the Hebrew word Allah or Alayan is a god. And it's foreign to some degree because they're from the heavens. All right, so these are children of fallen angels, and they're hiding that because if they told you what they were, you would believe in Christ. You would come back to the truth of God. And then you would be able to attach government with Satan worshiping. Okay? So it's a play, a total distortion to deceive the masses, like it said, the script, like Christ said. And they're using Christianity. What's that called?
Okay, let's go to Sister Sarah.
Yes.
Shalom. How are y'all doing?
Shalom.
Shalom.
Yeah, I had just two comments and kind of a question, really, but I'll make it quick. First of all, I agree completely that the guest that was on the phone knew a little bit more. I think that's why he was so adamant about being for Israel, whether they were all wrong or whether they were right, like you said in the beginning, because even the Most High wasn't for Israel when they were wrong. So, obviously, he knew more. And I also thought that it was interesting. He kept talking about DNA. And there's actually a documentary by PBS that brought out that a tribe in Africa of, all black people have that phenotype in them, linking them back to a Hebrew lineage. So, that was interesting as well. And the question or kind of comment I had to you, Brother Ricard, was about the Nephilim. I think the guest said something, I might be wrong, but he kind of alluded to the fact that after the flood, the Nephilim kind of did what they did again, to create more Nephilim or something. And I was thinking that, I've heard before a theory that after the flood came, you know, it destroyed the physical Nephilim, but the spirit, you know, couldn't be destroyed by water themselves, so they were still roaming the earth, and that's actually, you know, still the demons, and they still go into people today, but it's the same spirits that were in the days of Noah. And I wanted to hear your take on that or what you thought.
Well, number one, that is correct. The demons are from the hybrids, Nephilim seed. When the women came, when the fallen angels came to sleep with women and their children, and the book of Enoch could tell you that the judgment was their children would fall into a war, the clash of the Titan, and their spirits would operate on the earth and cause and attack and do battle, and go in, you know, and through sin would enter people. Now, when it comes to the other part you're speaking of how they got to the other end of the flood, I mean the other side of the flood, Genesis 6 tell you, in the days of Noah, there were giants in the land, and then after that. So it's telling you not only did that happen before the flood, it happened after the flood also, because the Amorites and the other children of Canaan began rituals under Satan that made more angels come down and bear giants. So you understand? So there were tablets, like the Gilgamesh tablets that was left after the flood, which Noah's sons got their hands on. They started doing rituals to call spirits down, to do different things of that nature. After the flood, it began the process again through Canaan's daughters. You understand? So that's how they reprocreated after the flood. Also, it's in legend, but it could be more than legend based on the fact that Og, king of Bashan, is operating on the other side of the flood. Og was one of the sons of the giants, king of Bashan. You can read of him in Genesis. There's legend that Og held on part of the ship until the water receded and held on to one of the mountains. And when the water receded, he came down into a cavern, into a cave for refuge for a time before he introduced himself in the earth again. So that one giant did make it through the flood. But that's legend, but there must be some truth to that legend because Og, O-G of Bashan, is living on the other side of the flood. Okay? So we got that. How long we got, Brother Gajah?
He's got about 10, 12 minutes left.
We have 11 more minutes. And also, if I could add to that, Elder Ricard, she mentioned about the DNA. And a few months back when I was doing my show, we had the largest DNA company, or the CEO of the largest DNA company, who was Jewish himself, and it was a defendant of Jewish. And when I probed him about this so-called Jewish DNA, he had to admit that this cause, the so-called Jewish DNA, it is not the Jewish DNA, but is the Shemitic or Sham DNA. And when I told him about the different nations that have this so-called Sham DNA, as we know, the Esau is also Shemitic. Ishmael is also Shemitic. Elam is also Shemitic.
Exactly.
Moab, Ammon is also Shemitic. So they're trying to, they know this. And when I told them that, how do we know that the Jewish people that are in Russia and in Germany are not descended from the Roman Empire, also who is, which are the Edomites, which also are Shemitic. And then, you know, the conversation went downhill from there. But don't let people trick you with this DNA. There is no such, they can, and even he admitted that there is no way to prove whether this is exactly a DNA directly from Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. It's just the closest they have thus far. I just want to drop
exactly.
that as well.
Right. Exactly. That means in order to know whether or not their test is correct, you must know what the original specimen was.
Right.
And then you have to trust the source.
Right.
So really, they're spinning it. Of course, if they were in control, they would find some DNA to say that they're the people. But outside of DNA, we have history that they converted into Judaism from the Khazarian Empire. So they can leave the DNA. That stuff is to fool the unlearned. But if you know history, history tells you they were someone else if they converted into Islam, I mean, into Judaism during the big conversion of Calvaria.
You know, and it just hit me. Now I know why they're pushing Khazars. I'm sorry, Ashkenaz. Because Ashkenaz, we all know, is Japheth.
Exactly.
So if they could prove that they got Shemitic lineage, which they do because they're Esau, they'll say, see, I'm Shem. I'm not Japheth.
Yeah. But you have to realize they came out of the bloodline of a black woman, Rebecca. So they came straight from a black man and black woman. So there would be some DNA link, but they know that there's a distinctive opposite DNA link between us and them.
To add to that, you know, with the Olympics just gone, and, you know, they were talking about, like, Usain Bolt and all of that, and what they were saying is that they were finding the DNA in the Europeans and the DNA with like Usain Bolt to be very similar, if not same. You understand me? And they were like, well, how come, you know the fast twitching fibers? And one of the things that people were realizing is that Esau and Jacob are twin brothers. So the Europeans will have the Edomites will have the DNA very similar to Shem, you know.
Exactly. So you can't choose Shem as a match because Shem was the father of many people.
Yes.
You understand? Many people came out of Shem, but we're talking about a distinct seed, and I'm going to say this real quick because I want to say this. They have genetic code weapons, map weapons, that can destroy people based on race. Now, in order to do this is what the reason they're really going into DNA for. They're looking to destroy the children of Israel throughout the four corners of the earth, and they know who we are. All right? So let's get the next person in, because I want to get at least two more phone calls before our minute is up. We only got about 5 minutes here.
Yeah, we got 5 minutes left.
All right, cool. Let's bring in Sister Dolores.
Shalom. Yeah, Shalom. Shalom.
You have 2 minutes, sister. Come on.
Okay, 2 minutes, real quickly. I just wanted to point out when in 1 Corinthians 14:34, when they keep saying that Paul taught against the law, but when he said to the women, let your women keep silent in the church, was not permitted unto them to speak, but they are commanded to be under obedience as also says the law. So my whole point is that when they say that Paul was teaching against the law, this clearly shows that he wasn't. But like you said, reading any of the books of Paul is hard for the unlearned, because it was hard for me until I started looking at those fine details, and I just wanted to point that out.
That is a key point, sister. You know what? We're going to use that for now on when they say Paul say the law is done away with. When you go in to keep silence in the church, thus saith the law. What law was Paul talking about? Is that
right.
Done away with? That's a key point. Thank you. We're going to utilize that.
Oh, great.
Thank you.
All right, shalom.
All right, bless you.
Right, let's
That's
see
pretty
you
good.
Get one more call in, Brother Greg.
Okay, wasn't Greg in earlier? Let's give someone else a chance.
Was he in?
He was in earlier.
Okay. All right, that wraps up the callers for tonight.
Okay, that's everyone in, right?
Everyone got a chance to say something.
Okay, let's see if we could get someone on soon can tell us why everyone is so adamant denying that the true children of Israel was people of color. Like, what's so wrong with the children of Israel being people of color? That's what we need to know. Bless you, brothers and sisters.
Yeah, man. We have Brother Azariah in the background, man, working on bringing in a lot of the guests that we've been having in. You know, I want to thank him.
Wonderful.
Yeah, man. With him continuing, you know, to do it, man. There's some homework. I know you're just giving him some new homework, you know.
Oh yeah, and you know he didn't ex Babylon, but he's still working hard. So all praise be to the brother. He's working hard wherever he is. He's all over the earth, but he's working.
Yeah, man. Listen, man. May the Most High continue to bless him, man, and continue to bless everyone here. Elder Rakar, thanks for coming on again. I know that the sometimes the time zone and the traveling is a bit hard. Keep going, you know, but you know. And thanks again to all the listeners who keep tuning in each week. And like, you know, the shows are archived, and you can go back and listen to the shows over again and make your points. And you know, may the Most High protect you until we talk again next week. All right, let's say shalom to everyone. Elder Gambar, thank you. Elder Ramar,
thank you
in the studio, helping out, and you know, for the entire family, man, just for making the show what it is. And bringing information out. All right? That was it. Shalom, sir.
Shalom, and bless you.